average work pants versus a giant angry beaver. Duluth trading fire hose work pants versus a giant angry beaver. Duluth trading fire hose work pants. Tougher than an angry beaver's teeth. Get a pair at DuluthTrading.com.
Hey everyone, I'm Liam McHugh, and once again we have a stacked Saturday of college football coming at you on Versus and NBC Sports. In mere moments, we'll kick things off with a contest simply known as The Game. In the 128th installment of this rivalry, Yale looks to derail Harvard's perfect Ivy League season. Then, at 3:30 Eastern, TCU hosts Colorado State. Before they bounce to the Big 12, the 19th-ranked Horned Frogs look to lock up a share of the Mountain West title. At 4 o'clock over on NBC, it's Notre Dame. Back in the top 25 for the first time since week one, the Fighting Irish look for their 8th win in their last 9 games as they welcome in Boston College. And finally, at 7:30, out in Pasadena, Colorado meets UCLA. The Bruins, already in the driver's seat in the Pac-12 South, are hoping to become bowl eligible. 4 games, 8 teams, bragging rights, titles, and perfection on the line. And it all starts right now.
Liam, as we prepare for the latest installment of this historic rivalry in New Haven, Connecticut, we have unfortunate breaking news. This morning, a young woman lost her life in an accident just outside the Yale Bowl. For more on that, let's go down to Carolyn Mano.
Well, Randy, the latest reports here indicate that the 30-year-old victim was a woman from the state of Massachusetts. Now, the reports that we're hearing say that she was hit in the D lot, which is about 500 yards from the Yale Bowl, by a Yale student who was driving that U-Haul and speeding in the parking lot. Now, she was said to have been under cardiac arrest right at the impact. She was taken to the hospital along with 2 other victims, one of which is in critical condition right now. We do not have anything confirmed at this time. We're waiting on the university to issue an official statement. If we do get that, I will give it to you. But right now, these are all the details we know. 30-year-old woman from Massachusetts killed here today in the D lot at the Yale Bowl. Randy.
All right. Thanks, Carolyn. As always, when these teams play, it's a very crowded scene with tailgating and more than 50,000 fans streaming in to the Yale Bowl. We'll be back for the kickoff of Harvard versus Yale after this.
Cincinnati, Ohio, linebacker.
I ate breakfast and got heartburn. Third day this week, so I took my heartburn pill and some antacids. We're having Mexican tonight, so another pill then? Unless we eat later, then pill later. If I get a snack now, pill now. Skip the snack, pill later. Late dinner, pill now? I have got heartburn in my head.
Stop the madness of treating frequent heartburn. It's simple with Prilosec OTC. One pill a day, 24 hours, zero heartburn.
No heartburn in the first place? Great.
$100 for a pair of jeans? Give me a break. I wear Lee Premium Select because they fit, they're comfortable, and they cost less than 50 bucks. And according to studies, I've been told they make my butt look good. Researcher.
Getting comfortable never looked so good.
There's a reason our KFC Famous Bowl is famous. Okay, 5 reasons. Layered together for what might be the world's best tasting full meal. How do we make that recipe even more famous?
We put bacon on it.
Wow. Another one for the Colonel. Introducing the new KFC Cheesy Bacon Bowl. Try it right now for only $3.99.
Everything's better with bacon.
No argument here, Rachel. Today's a KFC day. Today tastes so good.
Really? Head & Shoulders is for more than dandruff.
Yeah, it does 7 great things, like giving me a healthy scalp and great-looking hair.
We should make that 8 things.
Dude, why don't you just use this stuff?
Head & Shoulders. 7 benefits every bottle.
Tradition. There's nothing like it. And when it's Harvard versus Yale, this New England tradition is unbeatable, no matter who wins. I'm John Donahue, president of Arbella Insurance. At Arbella, we're from here. We get what makes this more than just a football game. And we're dedicated to providing the protection and security for the things that New Englanders care about. The pursuit of excellence on the field today is what we strive for as a company every day. Arbella Insurance. Here for tradition, here for good.
There's a line, that separates the mighty from the meek and the heroes from the humble. One very thin line. These are the moments you don't want to miss. And with Xfinity, you never will.
Catch every touchdown from every game Sunday afternoons with NFL Red Zone. Sign up now to get NFL Red Zone and more with the sports entertainment package for under $8 more a month. Call 1-800-XFINITY.
Welcome back to the Yale Bowl. It was 1959 when legendary New York sports columnist Red Smith was credited with popularizing the description of Harvard versus Yale as the game. And today's game has an added twist. For the first time in its history, Harvard has wrapped up an undisputed Ivy League championship before it plays Yale in the season-ending game. The Crimson did that last week with their victory against Penn. As you can see, they're currently 6-0 in Ivy League play. So Ross Tucker, since they have clinched the Ivy League title, even though this is a rivalry game, is there any concern that they may lose a little bit of that edge?
You know, I think a little bit. Talking with their coaches, including their head coach, Tim Murphy, he told us that he's never been in this situation. And not only has he never been in this situation, he doesn't know anyone that's ever been in this situation going into the final week of the season, where they haven't only won the title, they've won it and clinched it outright. It's a really unique situation. However, you talk to some of the players like we did this week, including fifth-year wide receiver Chris Lordich, and he said, yeah, we clinched the title, but when you talk to the alumni, you talk to the other students, this is still the game that matters to them. So Chris Lordich and the rest of the players promised us they would be fully motivated for today's contest.
Meanwhile, the Yale Bulldogs are trying to break a four-game losing streak against Harvard, and the big news all week has been their quarterback, Patrick Witt, who is here, suited up, will play. He bypassed a Rhodes Scholarship interview in Atlanta scheduled for today to join his teammates for the final game of his senior year.
And I really commend him for that decision, because he knows how valuable he is to his teammates and how important this game is. None of the Yale Bulldogs have ever beaten Harvard. They've never won the game. Without Patrick Witt, they wouldn't stand much of a chance. He is their main cog on offense, and him being here today, you can see how much it means to the rest of his Yale teammates.
Both teams fired up on the field, and of course, Ross, I mean, you've been through a similar situation, although you went on to play in the NFL, but for the vast majority of these seniors, this will be the last time they ever suit up to play a football game.
Well, and there's so many emotions surrounding that. You know, even when I played my final college game, I wasn't sure whether or not it was going to be my last game, but I still knew for a lot of my teammates, last time putting on the helmet, last time putting on the shoulder pads. You see Patrick, he'll probably get another chance at the next level to put on a helmet and shoulder pad. But for most of these guys, they've been playing football since 6, 7, 8 years old, and this is the last time they will ever strap it up. Yale's captain, Jordan Haynes, as you see the series history there, told us it's been hard this week to not think about last time doing this, last Wednesday practice, last Thursday morning lift. He's trying to temper the emotions of his teammates.
And Yale, of course, can be especially motivated for a win because of the recent history between these two teams. Harvard has beaten Yale, as you just saw, 9 of the last 10, 4 in a row, and 7 out of 8 here on Yale's home turf at the Yale Bowl.
Well, what's especially interesting about that, having done these games the last 2 years right here on Versus, Yale has really dominated the action for the most part. They've gotten the better in terms of yardage, moving the ball up and down the field, but they have not seen that result on the scoreboard that they're looking for. Obviously, they're hoping to turn this around today and send these seniors off with a memorable win.
Yale has won the toss. They have deferred to the second half. So Yale, wearing, of course, the home blue, will be kicking off, moving from left to right to Harvard. Both teams obviously very fired up for this historic rivalry. Saitu Smith, number 10, who missed last week's game against Penn, has returned from injury. He is deep. The freshman from Deerfield Beach, Florida. He's a threat. And that is Saitu Smith from the 5. Oh, yeah. And the freshman takes it out to about the 35-yard line where Harvard will get started with their senior quarterback, Collier Winters. There he is, number 16, who was actually outplayed Yale's Patrick Witt in the last two meetings the previous 2 years.
Collier, one of a handful of fifth-year seniors for Harvard, so he's getting a fifth semester his fourth year playing football, and one of the big reasons why he came back was to be able to play in the game yet again.
It'll be Winters in the shotgun. Fires it out complete to Adam Chrisis. Let's check our starting lineups now. Ross, starting with the Harvard offensive line.
Well, take a look at the left tackle, Kevin Murphy. He is a legitimate pro prospect. I actually think he'll end up getting drafted. With the wide receivers and the running backs, Chris Lordich, another one of those fifth-year seniors I talked about, was not able to play in this game last year due to injury.
All right, that last play gained 1 yard, the completion to Chrisis. Second and 9 for the Crimson. And that pass incomplete, Collier Winters, but we have a flag on the play. Winters took a big hit after the incompletion, but the penalty thrown in the defensive backfield. Your referee for this game.
Holding on the defense, 25, 10 yards from the original line of scrimmage. It's automatic first down.
Is Tony Marcella, and he gives us the call, a first down by penalty for Harvard.
One of the things you'll notice early on here is Harvard runs the no huddle. Now, it's not quite the up-tempo no huddle that you're used to seeing from Oregon or some of the other college football teams, but they very rarely huddle. They do everything up on the line of scrimmage. There's a lot of reasons for that, and we'll detail that over the course of the game.
Ryan Falbo, number 25, was whistled for that penalty, and Harvard will go right back to the air, and that one in the breadbasket of Chrisis, but he just couldn't hold on. Now let's look at some more lineups here as we take a look at the Yale defense.
Jake Stoller is a guy that had 3 Big Ten offers and yet another player in this game that might get a shot at the next level. Jordan Haynes, the captain in the middle, one of the leading tacklers in the Ivy League. And on the back end, Drew Baldwin, one of the better cover corners in the Ivies.
On second and 10, Trevor Scales, the junior, gets the carry and takes it to about the 50-yard line. Jordan Haynes, the middle linebacker, the senior middle linebacker for Yale, makes the stop in what he has described as the biggest game of his life.
Yeah, he's talked about all week trying to control and temper the emotions of some of the other guys on Yale's squad that haven't had a chance to get as much playing time in this game as he has.
So Harvard facing a 3rd and 7. They got off to a bit of a slow start last week against Penn. Winters is going to run for this first down. And Collier Winters, showing that he's got some feet to go with his arm, takes it to the 30-yard line where Nick Okano, the strong safety, ran him out of bounds.
Take a look at Will McHale, number 5. He'll blitz, and Winters makes a miss. And then once he makes McHale miss, there's nothing but real estate in front of him. And this is exactly what Winters has done the last 2 years. Yale head coach Tom Williams said, as much as anything, he's killed us with his feet.
First down on the 28. Winters complete to Chris Lordich. Lordich puts his shoulder down and gets to about the 15-yard line. He's a senior. Nick Okano again with the stop. As Harvard now gets into the red zone of Yale, this has been one of their strengths all season. They've scored on 77%. That's touchdowns of their red zone penetrations. On defense, they've only given up 42%, and Yale has struggled, as you saw, all season offensively and defensively in the red zone. A fake to Trevor Scales, and Collier Winters fumbles the ball into the end zone. And it is a touchback. Will McHale knocked the ball out.
Fumble
as Winters
forward, out of bounds through the end zone. Result of the play is a touchback. First down, Yale.
Winters lost the handle. And a big turnover now as Yale takes over.
What a huge play early in this game. It's the read option. Winters tucks it away. Watch the ball. It pops out there. Clearly a fumble. Nobody was able to recover it in the field of play. Remember, if you fumble and it goes out of the end zone, that is a touchback. Huge break for the Bulldogs early in this one.
Harvard was driving. They'd started that drive on their 35-yard line. But the Bulldogs will take over with Patrick Witt and Alex Thomas in the backfield. That's Deion Randall, number two, coming in motion. Witt fires it out to Randall. Randall takes it out to about the 26-yard line where Bobby Snyder, the linebacker, made the stop for Harvard.
All Patrick Witt's done in his 3 years here in New Haven is set just about every Yale Bulldog passing record. Number one in completions, attempts, yards, number three in touchdowns ever since he transferred here from Nebraska.
That was a pickup of six, second and four. In Witt's two previous games against Harvard, though, he's yet to throw a touchdown pass. And that one was a screen pass intended for Alex Thomas, a little bit off the mark as Witt is knocked to the ground. Now let's check back in to some more starting lineups with the Yale offensive line.
I've got my eyes on Gabe Fernandez. He's got a tough one-on-one matchup against Josue Ortiz all game long. When you take a look at the backs, Deion Randall, we've already seen him get the ball one time. He is a dynamic playmaker in space for the Ivy League.
Ortiz had two sacks, actually a sack and a half against Yale last year, and also a key block punt in the second half, so that could be a very important matchup on third and four. Witt fires incomplete. Deion Randall in the vicinity, but didn't even turn around for that one. Some miscommunication there, and Yale does not capitalize on the turnover, and the Bulldogs will have to punt it away. Number 37, their freshman punter, Kyle Cazetta, will be punting it away to Scott Miller, number 25, who is deep for Harvard. Cazetta averaging 34.6. It's a very windy day. The wind is swirling here at the Yale Bowl. It's hard to tell exactly which direction it's blowing, but it did impact some of the punts and field goals in warm-ups. But Cazetta booms this one over the head of Miller. It lands at the 20. What a punt by Kyle Cazetta from the 36-yard line all the way to the 14, where the Harvard Crimson will take over for their second possession.
Would you shine a little bit brighter, climb a little bit higher? Tell me, won't you shine for me? Won't you hold a little bit longer, sing a little bit louder? Tell me, won't you shine for me?
Introducing the official training bike of the Tour de France, the ProForm TDF, the first ever indoor training bike that delivers everything you demand. A 20% incline and a 20% decline, so you'll experience exactly what the road does. Because it's powered by Google Maps, you choose the road and the TDF follows it. Every incline and decline, so no matter what comes at you, you'll be ready. The ProForm TDF automatically adjusts resistance, incline and decline. Plus, with a built-in power meter, you'll know your exact output. You decide where to go, and the official training bike of the Tour takes you there. And now that you've decided, we're ready to deliver. Order right now and get zero down and a free upgrade on rush shipping. Call the number on your screen or go online today.
Final word on Saturday doesn't come till Monday night with College Football Talk. Join hosts Liam McHugh, Ross Tucker, and Glenn Parker. Plus, a sit-down with Coach Kelly for all your Notre Dame news. Every Monday at 5, College Football Talk on Versus.
There's the young freshman punter, Kyle Cazetta, telling his teammates how he did it. A 61-yard punt that has driven Harvard back now to the 13-yard line where they will start their next possession. As you can see, Yale and Harvard both have 14 Ivy League championships. Harvard, of course, clinching the undisputed Ivy League title for this year last week with their win against the Penn Quakers. And after that punt, Harvard will take over at the 13 with Collier Winters. Right next to him is the freshman, Zach Bowden. It's a fake to Bowden, and Winters fires it out to the right side, complete to Alex Sarkisian, a senior who caught a big fourth quarter touchdown pass last year in this game against Yale. We have an injured player on the field. It's Nick Okano, number 20, who's already been in on a couple of stops for Yale. He's a sophomore, strong safety.
And if you're a guy like Okano starting as a sophomore in this game, that shows you how talented he is. Went to Harvard Westlake High School out in California, and he's been a really pleasant surprise. Let's see what happened. He gets over there. Sarkisian falls down right into his leg.
Okano has four passes broken up this season, and he's already had a couple of big plays in this game. And he is being helped off the field. So that completion to Sarkisian was 6 yards, so it'll be second down and 4 here for Harvard. We'll try to get a report on Okano a little later.
Okano has been replaced by John Powers at safety. Powers has been a special teams dynamo all year long for Yale.
He was voted their special teams player of the year last season. So on second down and 4. That is Collier Winter scrambling in the backfield, and Jordan Haynes making another stop to reel him in for a big loss back to the 14.
It looked like a broken play. You can see the snap was high into the right for Winters. What athleticism and a lucky bounce that he was able to have that ball bounce right back up to him. Harvard avoids near disaster right there. Could have been their second fumble of the game deep in their own territory this time.
Footballs usually don't bounce that nicely, but it did for Winters that time. And now this is 3rd and 9. And that pass is completed to Kyle Juszczyk, but well short of the first down at about the 18-yard line, 19. Juszczyk is one of two tight ends, Cameron Brait, number 87, being the other one that will be in for almost every offensive snap for Harvard. Colin Bibb, number 21, made the stop on Juszczyk, and it forces Harvard into a punting situation.
Well, and having those two tight ends playing as well as they do has been such a weapon for Harvard. Those two guys have combined for 52 catches, 753 yards, and 13 touchdowns, and really present matchup issues for the defense because of their size and athleticism.
Jacob Dombrowski punting. Gio Christodoulou lets the ball bounce. Yale's all-time leading punt returner. No return on that one, though. A short punt to the 46-yard line. The game. We have no score with 10:17 left in the first quarter.
The spike is trying. Free agent. Beer. Foster's, Australian for beer.
This is for Cindy. I wanted to get her something special this year.
You went to Kay. She'll love it. Trust me, I know.
More milk?
Thanks, Dave, but I gotta fly.
Bulova watches are designed to be noticed. Save 25% on Bulova watches at Kay Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America.
I love it.
Santa said you would. No, really.
Every kiss begins with K.
Walter Camp.
Yale.
John Heisman.
Penn.
Pop Warner.
Cornell.
American football was born in the Ivy League. With 53 national champions, 3 Heisman Trophy winners, and an honor roll of national leaders and NFL stars, its campuses are the gold standard for academic and athletic achievement. The 8 Ivy League schools built a game. Tradition lives here.
I started balding, I didn't like it, and I'm doing something about it.
Only Rogaine Foam is shown to regrow hair in 85% of guys.
I'm like, hey, look at me, it's working.
Go to RogaineFoam.com, and you can get a 4-month supply of Rogaine for just $59.95. Order in the next 10 minutes and get free shipping.
Get the whole story with NBC Sports Talk. Mondays and Fridays, join our NFL analysts.
He is the heart and soul of that offense right now. Not Jay Cutler, it's Matt Forte.
Tuesday through Thursday, we'll take you deeper inside all the breaking stories. NBC Sports Talk on Versus.
Welcome back. We have an interesting take this week on our go-to guy. That's Chris Smith on the sideline. And If he were playing, he would definitely be our Kay Jewelers go-to guy, but it's important that he's not in the lineup.
Well, it's a real bummer for Yale because he is one of the most dynamic players in the Ivy League. He had a stretch there where he had over 100 yards receiving in three straight games. Unfortunately, he has an injured hamstring and does not allow him to go today.
One of the primary weapons for the Yale offense on not just receiving, kick returns as well. And they'll be without him here as Yale starts at the 47.
Well, and without Chris Smith, they're going to have to really spread the ball around to all the receivers and both running backs.
And that is Alex Thomas in the backfield, the Connecticut High School superstar now in his senior year, his final game. Dan Minamidi with the stop there on Alex Thomas. We mentioned he's a Connecticut High School Phenom. This is a guy, unbelievably, in his senior year, averaged 277 yards a game rushing. That's incredible.
Well, the numbers are eye-popping. Almost 8,300 yards, 114 touchdowns. I asked him this week when we talked to him, when you go back home to Ansonia, do they talk about Yale or high school? He says, still high school.
No wonder. That's Patrick Witt keeping the ball there, getting close to the first down. Alex Gideon on the shot. Let's take a look at the Harvard defensive lineups.
Well, you're looking at Josue Ortiz right there. Got a great opportunity to be the defensive player of the year in the Ivy League. Leads the league with 9 sacks. At the linebacker level, the captain, the middle linebacker, Alex Gideon from just outside of Cleveland. And on the back end, Dan Minamidi had a big game last week in the Ivy clincher over Penn.
Witt carried to the 38-yard line. It'll be third and a little more than a yard. And Alex Thomas breaks through the center of the line. Big hole for Thomas as he gets the first down to around the 30.
Yale has something here, Randy. That's three straight plays where they are taking it right at the Harvard defense. As you see Nick O'Connell back out there testing it. But offensively, that's three straight runs by Yale. And I'm telling you, doing this game the last 2 years, even though they've been the underdog, even though they've lost, they have really won the battle of the trenches.
Last year they had almost double the yardage of Harvard, as Thomas carries again there. Almost double the yardage of Harvard, but it was really special teams problems in the second half that led to the defeat by Yale. Harvard returned the second half kickoff for a touchdown. They blocked a punt to set up another touchdown.
At this point in the field of play, it is critical that Yale get some points on the board. Their field goal kicker, Philip Panico, his career long is 39 yards. They're not quite there yet, but anytime you're in a rivalry game like this, you got to get the first points on the board.
On second and 7, Witt completing the pass out to the sideline there to number 18, Keith Cody, the starting tight end, his 12th catch of the season.
Just a quick out pattern by Patrick Witt. Relatively easy pitch and catch for him. And it presents a very manageable 3rd and 4. You always hear people say on TV, manageable. What does that mean? Well, what it means is there are a lot of different plays that you can run and a lot of different crossing routes that make it easy to get the 5 or 6 yards. You always hear manageable. Nobody ever tells you what that means. It means it's a lot easier to throw a 5 or 6 yard pass here.
And this could involve Deion Randall, number 2, who is in the backfield. Witt looking for him. He's not open. Fires over the middle, and that is complete to Jackson Liguori for the touchdown. The sophomore from Pacific Palisades, California, due to the injury to Chris Smith, has seen a lot more playing time the last couple of weeks. And that's a touchdown from Patrick Witt. 10 catches for 123 yards last week against Princeton. And Liguori has put the Yale Bulldogs on the board first. Felipe Panico attempting the point after. And Yale strikes first blood in the game. A touchdown pass to the young Liguori has put the Bulldogs up 7-0. But Harvard has come from behind to beat Yale the last two meetings.
lead the run. Rated T for teen.
Capital One's new cash rewards card gives you a 50% annual bonus, so you earn 50% more cash. According to research, everybody likes more cash. Well, almost everybody. Would you like 50% more cash?
No.
But it's more money.
The new Capital One cash rewards card. The card for people who want 50% more cash.
What's in your wallet? Whoa!
It's easy to see what Subaru owners care about. That's why we created the Share the Love event. Get a great deal on a new Subaru, and $250 goes to your choice of five charities. With your help, we can reach $20 million by the end of this, our fourth year.
There is young Jackson Legore, the recipient of that 24-yard touchdown pass from Patrick Witt. We said Witt hadn't thrown a touchdown pass against Harvard the last 2 years. Well, he has now.
Well, look at the right side of your screen. You'll notice two things. Number one, you'll notice how much time Patrick Witt has. Then you'll see Jackson Legore, 84. He settles down in the zone, kind of slowed down, and then sped up again. And the Harvard Crimson defenders lost him. Good hesitation move by Jackson Legore. Then he breaks one tackle for the score.
Josue Ortiz, the sack leader in the Ivy League, couldn't apply any pressure to Patrick Witt on that one.
Well, and that was really the key to the play. I mean, Patrick Witt had all day. You don't expect that with the Harvard defensive line. That really is the strength of the defense. Every coach you talk to talks about the Harvard defensive line, but give some credit to the Yale O-line for some of the runs they had on that drive, and then all the time for Witt on the touchdown pass.
So this is a common theme. Yale has jumped out on top of Harvard. Saitu Smith again from the 10-yard line. Smith brings it back to the 27-yard line. A 16-yard return. And let's see now what this high-powered Harvard offense can do. Averaging 467 yards of total offense in Ivy League play. A bit of a slow start last week against Penn, but then they lit it up.
Well, you got that right. I mean, they've scored 30-plus points in seven straight games. That's the first time Harvard has done that since 1890. Think about that.
A fake to Trevor Scales. And that pass completed. An excellent catch by Chris Lordich in traffic. Kurt Stottlemyre, number six, was all over Lordich. It looked like good coverage, but well thrown, and Lordich brought it in for the first down.
Well, you said it, Randy. Kurt Stottlemyre was all over Lordich, but a perfect throw and a great catch can beat excellent coverage, and it did right there.
Pick up of 13 yards to the 39. Trevor Scales slung down by Pat Moran, number 92.
Pat Moran was hurt. Not able to play in this game last year. He is all of 6'5", 300 pounds. He was right in the middle of your screen. Little inside move. They will just lasso down Trevor Scales. You can see how fired up these Yale seniors are early on.
That was a loss of two, second and 12. Trevor Scales getting all that back and more, putting his head down. Bulling for first down yardage to midfield. Jeff Dunham, number 11, made the stop, but I think Dunham took the worst of that particular collision.
What makes this Harvard offense so prolific and so unique is they don't really have any stars. There's not one guy that you say he's the guy you have to slow down. They've got two tight ends, four wide receivers, two running backs. They even have two quarterbacks. They're all good.
Colton Chappell, the backup quarterback, performed admirably when Winters missed four games with a pulled hamstring a little earlier. That was a gain of 12, and here he is again. Trevor Scales, after a first down on the previous carry, picks up about 4 yards into Yale territory to the 46-yard line. This two tight end offense has been mentioned by Tim Murphy as one of the keys to Harvard's offensive renaissance this year.
Well, I was teasing him. I said, you guys are like the Patriots with Rob Gronkowski and Aaron Hernandez, because when you have two tight ends, you can split them out as if they're wide receivers, or you can put them both attached to the line of scrimmage like two more offensive tackles.
And that's Alex Sarkisian taking the pass from Winters, getting a first down. inside the 35-yard line to the 33. Nick O'Connell, we saw him being helped off the field on the previous possession. Looked like it could be a pretty painful injury. That was O'Connell right there on the stop, back in the game.
Well, that's a great sign. You love to see that. You don't want to see anybody get injured, especially when they have an opportunity to play in a game like this.
That play took it to the 33-yard line. Harvard on the move again, and there's Trevor Scales again. Stop this time, Matt Battaglia, number 7 on the interior of the line. In on the stop, a pickup of only about a yard. Let's go down to Carolyn Manning.
Well, Randy, you saw Nick O'Connell take the field. He was getting his right knee worked on in the tunnel for about 10 minutes. You saw him run back out and do a little bit of footwork. He actually went back into the tunnel. His coach is asking him if he was okay. He's shaking his head yes, Randy.
So the sophomore back in the lineup at safety. No gain on that last carry by Scales. 2nd and 10. 5 wide receivers now for Harvard.
Empty set can be a good time for a quarterback run.
Winters is going to fire it out, and that is complete to Zach Bowden, the freshman. He's inside the 10, inside the 5. Bowden to the 4-yard line, where Jordan Haynes dropping back into coverage as the middle linebacker finally made the stop.
Yep, Bowden was to Collier Winters' left, to our right, and he makes one guy miss. Jeff Dunham, number 11, right there, cuts it all the way back, and much like he did last week against Penn, this freshman has become a primetime performer.
That was
for
a
Harvard.
29-yard pickup on that last pass to Bowden. First and goal. That's a fake to Bowden, and Winters is going to try to run it in himself, and he does. Touchdown, Harvard. A 4-yard run by Collier Winters, his 7th rushing touchdown of the season. As the Crimson launch a drive to match Yale's last touchdown.
Anytime you have a quarterback like Collier Winters that is that accomplished of a runner, he had a game this year against Dartmouth with over 100 yards. They can be such a deadly weapon inside the red zone, especially because it enables you to have an extra blocker.
David Moffender with the point after. And we are tied with 3:59 remaining in the first quarter. Harvard bounces back with an 8-play, 73-yard drive, capped by that 4-yard touchdown run by Collier Winters.
You want to save money on car insurance? No problem. You want to save money on RV insurance? No problem. You want to save money on motorcycle insurance? No problem. You want to find a place to park all these things? Forget about it. This is New York.
Hey, little guy, wake up.
Oh, calm off it, Mike.
Geico. Saving people money on more than just car insurance.
USA Prime Credit. Tell Peggy your problem.
Hey, Peggy, I got 5 dadgum charges here for Miss Priss's Cat Emporium.
Dadgum?
Now, Peggy, tell me, do I sound like a man who'd have 5 dadgum charges at a Miss Priss's Cat Emporium?
You break up. Call back next week.
I'm not too old to find you, son.
Want better customer service? Switch to Discover. Ranked number 1 in customer loyalty. It pays to Discover.
Crouching in average jeans. Crouching in Duluth Trading Ballroom jeans. Duluth Trading Ballroom jeans. The crotch gusset gives you room to crouch without singing soprano. Get a pair at DuluthTrading.com.
They brave the deadliest conditions.
Heavy seas, heavy surf. It's not a good combination.
But when Alaska's weather is at its worst, they're at their best.
We all do this job to save lives.
Coast Guard Alaska, Wednesday at 9 on the Weather Channel.
There's a look at Harvard head coach Tim Murphy congratulating Collier Winters for that last touchdown run in the game. Of course, the Ivy League, the cradle of American football. It was around when American football morphed from rugby. And look at all those firsts, Ross, including the first onside kick.
That had to be a surprise. The first one ever? Hey, you guys can't do that. Yeah, we can. We just invented it.
They didn't even know what to call it back then. The first American sporting event with a crowd of over 80,000. History in the Ivy League, and the game has been a key part of that history. Both quarterbacks off to a fast start. Collier Winters 7-for-8 for 78 yards, 4 rushes for 37 yards, including that touchdown run, and we are tied at 7. A high, short kickoff. It's actually going to bounce to Christodoulou. And by the time Christodoulou got his hands on it, the Harvard Crimson special teams were all over him. Chris Splinter, number one, is the one that dragged Christodoulou down at the 23-yard line, where it'll be first down for Yale.
I think that was a really important answer by the Harvard Crimson, because there's all these questions of motivation with them already having wrapped up the outright Ivy League title. For them to answer that Yale score was huge.
Looks like we've got another good one here. Mordecai Cargill, who shares playing time in the offensive backfield with Alex Thomas. Dan Minamidi, the free safety, the senior for Harvard, in on the stop.
How many people hit Mordecai Cargill on this play? One right there. There's a second one. He keeps going. Third, fourth, and here comes 5, 6, 7, and 8. Mordecai Cargill had a great game in the snow several weeks back at Columbia. He's not a speed demon, but extremely powerful at 220 pounds out of Glenville High School in Cleveland.
Yeah, Ed Witt misfires on that one, intended for Deion Randall. It'll be 3rd and 5. Cargill, Alex Thomas was hurt in that game you mentioned against Columbia. Cargill carried 42 times for 230 yards. And 2 touchdowns in that game.
Well, and I was there, and the snow just kept coming and coming and coming, and it was sideways snow, and they really didn't have any other options other than that, and he made the most of it. Let's see if he can make the most of this play here on 3rd and 5.
Cargill still in the backfield, blocking for Witt. Witt over the middle, and that is complete to Jackson LaGoria again, and the ball comes out. Still loose. Recovered by Harvard. Recovered by number 30, Jaron Wilson, sophomore corner. So LaGoria catches the touchdown pass on one drive and coughs up a fumble to Harvard on the next.
It's a perfect throw from Patrick Witt. Again, he had time. The good blitz pickup. He rifles it in there on the slant. LaGoria clearly has possession, and when he tries to tuck it away, Owusu comes in, number 6, and knocks it away. Harvard jumps on it. Ball's been on the ground a lot early in this game.
So Harvard will take over at the 43-yard line, its own 43. Trevor Scales in the backfield with Winters. Winters is in trouble. Gets rid of it in the vicinity of Scales, close enough to avoid intentional grounding. Drew Baldwin, number 1, in on the pressure. There was a lot of pressure on that play.
Yes, there was. Really a good job by Winters just to get rid of the ball. You see Jackson LaGoria. It's pretty crazy, isn't it, how quickly you can go from making a great play on a touchdown to fumbling it. Football is a very fickle game. He'll get more off chances.
That pass complete to Matt Brown, his 7th catch of the season.
Brown's an interesting player for Harvard. He actually plays on Tommy Amaker's basketball team as well. Tommy Amaker's done a good job there at Harvard, turning that program around. They lost an Ivy League championship playoff to my alma mater, the Princeton Tigers, last year to decide who would go to the NCAA tournament.
The 6'3" Matt Brown, a pickup of 4 yards, 3rd and 6 for Harvard. And that is complete to Alex Sarkisian for first down yardage. Sarkisian, a couple of big receptions already. That one to the 44 of Yale.
Yeah, just too soft and too easy right there in the coverage. You'll see Sarkisian right there at the top. He just sits down in the zone. And Colin Bibb, 21, ran with the inside receiver. Nobody really had eyes for Sarkisian.
Collier Winters now 9 for 11 for 91 yards. He's had a couple of good games against Yale the previous 2 years. That one he hands off. And that was Trevor Scales for no gain to the 44. The last 2 years combined against Yale, Collier Winters has gone 32 for 42, 335 yards, three touchdowns, no interceptions. So this rivalry with Yale seems to bring out the best in Collier. Trevor Scales again across the 40-yard line. Scales getting a lot of action here in the first quarter.
Yeah, I always think it's interesting when you set up a play like this. You've got third and five from the 39. If you know you're going to go for it on fourth down because it could be four down territory, too long for a field goal, maybe too close for a punt, then it can change your play call a little bit. If you know you're going to punt it if you don't get it, then you're probably going to have to.
Let's see what they do on third and five. It's a fake to Scales, and that's a complete pass to Kyle Juszczyk for the first down.
Really like the design of that play right there. Collier Winters, watch him fake the handoff to Bowden, and you can see the linebacker, Will McHale, steps up just enough that Juszczyk could run by him. All those fakes to the running back out of the shotgun, it might not look like much, but it's enough that it holds the linebackers and opens up some passing lanes.
Harvard now 3 for 4 on third down conversions. That's complete to Lordich again. If Harvard was a little rusty on the first possession, as they were last week against Penn, for the second consecutive week, they've certainly snapped out of that. Dawson Holliday in on the stop there, a pickup of 7 yards, second and three.
And here comes the no huddle again. Harvard doesn't allow you to have any breathing room. They keep the tempo going, and Collier Winters able to look over the sideline and see what Joel Lamb wants to call.
And see if the freshman gets the ball. Yeah, there's Zach Bowden again, and Bowden looks like he has the first down to about the 20-yard line. Will McHale, number five, makes the stop.
It was nice getting a chance to talk with Zach Bowden, the freshman running back for Harvard this week. I was kind of reminiscing and wishing I could be playing college football, and then he said, in 25 minutes, I have my econ final. All right, I'm glad I'm done.
And that wraps up the first quarter, as Harvard is again on the move. When we begin the second quarter, they'll have a first down from the 20-yard line of the Yale Bulldogs. One of college football's historic rivalries here from the Yale Bowl at the end of a quarter. We are all tied at 7.
There is a reason our KFC Famous Bowl is famous. Okay, 5 reasons. Layered together for what might be the world's best tasting full meal. How do we make that recipe even more famous?
We put bacon on it.
Wow, another one for the Colonel. Introducing the new KFC Cheesy Bacon Bowl. Try it right now for only $3.99.
Everything's better with bacon.
No argument here, Rachel. Today's a KFC day. Today tastes so good.
Feeling vulnerable?
Oh. I bought my car insurance policy online without an agent.
Now I feel totally unprotected.
With a local Arbella independent agent, you'll get coverage that, well, covers you. Go to Arbella.com to find an independent agent near you.
Monday, Sagan leads the Bruins into Montreal against Subban and the Canadiens. Tuesday, Kopitar and the Kings battle the Blues. Next week, the NHL is on Versus.
What do you get when you become a City Thank You Premier Card member? 50,000 thank you points when you spend $2,500. That's right, 50,000 thank you reward points. But what can you get with those 50,000 points?
I got this amazing flat screen TV.
For only 41,000 points, I got a kayak for weekends at the lake.
We used our points to get $500 in gift cards for our nephews.
In addition to 50,000 thank you points, you also get a companion airline ticket on us right away. And another airline ticket every year after that. Call 800-601-8823 now. Become a card member and earn 50,000 thank you points and airline tickets. And you'll also get our 0% introductory APR offer. Plus, no annual fee for the first year.
There are no point caps, no expiration on points, and no blackout dates. Call 800-601-8823 today for your Citi Thank You Premier card. Or visit citi.com/rewards.
College football on Versus is presented by Lowe's for all your home improvement needs. Lowe's, never stop improving. By Foster's, Australian for beer. And by K Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America. Every kiss begins with K. As you see, the crowd of 50,000 plus packed into the Yale Bowl, the first bowl-shaped stadium in the United States, circa 1914, the inspiration for the Michigan Stadium, the Rose Bowl, the Los Angeles Memorial Coliseum. This place just dripping with history. As Harvard now starts the second quarter with first and 10 from the 20, and he started with a touchdown. Collier Winters to Alex Sarkisian for that 20-yard strike. Great protection by the Harvard offensive line. And the part about perhaps the Crimson may be losing a little bit of an edge in motivation, I think we can throw that right out the window.
Yeah, I think that's done. You see Alex Sarkisian and Collier Winters hooking up again. Harvard's offense, it really is a machine. I mean, you can't give it enough due with superlatives what they've been able to accomplish this year.
A second touchdown catch against Yale in 2 years for the senior from Valparaiso, Indiana. As David Mothender adds the extra point. That's now 191 yards of total offense already in this game and 11 first downs for the Harvard Crimson.
Again, it was the fake by Winters and Sarkisian being able to run free through the middle of the field. What's happening, Randy, is they keep freezing the linebackers just with that little fake, because if you're a linebacker, you can't start to drop back into your pass drop until you make sure that Winters doesn't hand the football off. By the time you start your drop, the ball's already over your head. You see what Tim Murphy's been able to do in terms of perfect seasons.
Harvard had not had a perfect Ivy League season from the time the Ivy League officially began in 56 until he arrived on the scene in 1994. And now the Crimson are shooting for their fifth since Murphy's arrival.
Very, very impressive. Not easy to do. A lot of times you'll win the Ivy League with one loss. You'll share the Ivy League. To go perfect, to win it outright, is something special.
That was a 9-play, 57-yard drive. Took only 3 minutes and 10 seconds, and of course culminated in that 20-yard touchdown pass from Winters to Sarkisian. 14-7 Harvard. Gio Christodoulou, number 30, is deep to receive the kick from Mothender. And this kick will be with the wind, except it's not going to go in the air. Taken by an up man for Yale. Don't know quite the inspiration behind that kick. That was, I believe, number 92, Pat Moran, one of the linemen. That was Pat Moran, who returns it to about the 43-yard line.
What a great job by Moran fielding that ball. I mean, look at him. He's all 6'5", 300. You see the kick, clearly by design. I guess they were trying to fool him with an onside kick. I'm not exactly sure what the thought process was, but Moran showing some hands and athleticism. Don't underestimate that fielding of the football by him. That's not easy. I've been there.
Moran, the kid who took 18 months off to help his father in a re-election campaign a couple of years ago. His father is James Moran, U.S. representative from Virginia. Alex Thomas on first down for Yale gets the carry for short yardage. Thomas missed a couple of games with a knee injury a little bit earlier this season. They call him Train for several reasons. His strength is one of them. Pickup of just a yard on that play by Thomas.
Yale needs to take advantage of this. I mean, getting this type of field position after that awkward kickoff, to say the least, they need to convert this into points.
Second and 9. Witt looking to the sideline, and that is complete. Back to Jackson Ligori, who has already caught a touchdown pass and had a fumble that led to a Harvard touchdown. Great protection again for Witt.
Well, Yale's going to put up a lot of points, and Patrick Witt's going to have a huge day if he keeps having this much time to throw. You see John Oppenheimer, the center, running one defender past Witt. Witt steps up in the pocket like a good short quarterback should and delivers a strike to Lagori, who's clearly the go-to guy these days.
That was a first down. Witt, you saw 5 for 8. Back to the ground to Alex Thomas, who had 3 touchdown runs against Harvard a year ago. They were all short yardage. The year before, in 2009, he ran for 124 yards against Harvard. That was a pickup of 7.
Patrick Witt told us this week, and Alex Thomas echoed his thoughts, there's no fear from the Yale side. Yeah, they've lost the last couple years. Yes, none of these Yale Bulldogs have beaten Harvard, but they've played with them, and in fact, they've controlled the action.
You don't see this that often. Witt on a design carry, and he wishes it hadn't happened. He is smashed to the ground for a loss of yardage by number 36, DJ Monroe, who lost his helmet in the process.
Again, I said earlier, you see Patrick Witt, you get the extra blocker in the formation when the quarterback runs, and as he's stiff-arming one defender, John Mason, number 2, Monroe comes up and gives him quite the shot. Usually when you have a quarterback like Patrick Witt, you're nervous about him taking that many hits, but I guess it's the last game. He's a senior. Put it all on the line today.
You're going to take that kind of a hit. You don't want it to be for a loss of 1. It's 3rd and 4. Witt fires over the middle. Beautifully thrown and complete for a first down. And number 9, Cameron Sandquist, sophomore from Redmond, Virginia. 6 for 9 now for Patrick Witt. That's a first down to the 23-yard line.
Witt had all kinds of time to throw on this play, and again last week against Princeton. He was 26 to 33, 379 yards and 3 touchdowns last week without Chris Smith, because he got the time. When he gets the time, he is pinpoint accurate.
A transfer from Nebraska, Patrick Witt, going up top again, looking for somebody. Finally dumps it off, incomplete. Alex Thomas tried to bring it in, but the pass was delivered a little low by Witt. Patrick Witt, a classic pocket passer with NFL aspirations, but that one a little shy.
Yeah, well, he had all kinds of time, and he used his movement skills, got wide a little bit. I think Patrick will tell you he should have thrown a better ball, and Alex Thomas will probably tell you he should have caught it.
It could have been caught, it looked like.
That's a big play, though, there, because you got to figure Alex Thomas in open space like that would have been able to get several yards. Now it brings up 2nd and 10.
Thomas not quite as accomplished a receiver as his backfield mate Mordecai Cargill this season, at least statistically. Thomas will get the run there, breaks a tackle. Gets to about the 16-yard line.
That's just the read option right there. You see that at every level of football. Even the NFL with Tim Tebow these days with the read option. You'll see Patrick Witt gives it to Alex Thomas. Now, he could have elected to run it himself as well. He's reading off of 62, the defensive end, John Lyon.
Thomas, 6 carries for 30 yards. Brings up a 3rd and 3. They're going to give it to Thomas again, and he is stacked up for no gain. Jack Dittmer, sophomore, number 56, backup defensive tackle. There he is, in on the stop.
One of the real strengths of this Harvard team is their depth. They play up to 10 defensive linemen, including Dittmer right there. Only a sophomore. That was a critical stop. Sets up this Panico field goal attempt.
Felipe Panico. Try a 34-yard field goal. Blocked. Blocked by Harvard. This year, Panico has had 4 extra points blocked. And now a field goal. It looked like it might have been kicked a little low into the Harvard line there, but Yale does not capitalize on that short kickoff.
Take a look at what happened. Right side of your screen, looks like number 1, Chris Splinter. What a job. And what a last name for a guy that splits 2 blockers to come in and block the kick. Splinter split him and blocked it.
And it looked like actually the ball wasn't really kicked low, just penetration by Splinter.
No, that's not on Panico there. That's on the blocking unit.
So Harvard will take over at the 13-yard line with Trevor Scales getting big yardage. still on his feet. Scales from the 13 out to about the 27-yard line. 14-yard pickup, Jordan Haynes. Again, in on the stop along with John Powers.
What a play by Splinter right there. He came off the edge, and he split right between the tight end and the wing back and was able to come in and get a hand on it. Tremendously athletic play. And for whatever reason, anytime there's a blocked kick or a blocked punt, it always invigorates the rest of the team.
On first down, Winters sends it out of the backfield to Bowden, and he's got big yardage to the 50, to the 40, 5-yard line where he's out of bounds. Bowden doing it on the ground and through the air.
They lost him. That's the guy that Collier Winters faked to. Take a look at it. He'll fake to Bowden. Actually, Bowden went the wrong way, I think. And Winters didn't fake to him. Then when he went out to the right side, he was absolutely wide open. Almost. That looked awkward. I think Winters faked the wrong way. He faked out everybody, including Bowden. It worked.
For first down yardage, Bowden has two catches for 56 yards already. There's Sarkisian, who just caught the touchdown pass moments ago. Close to another first down, but about a yard shy at the 36-yard line. And the Harvard offense right now is clicking on all cylinders.
Boy, are they ever. I think we're getting a chance to see right now why they have been so dominant in the Ivy League, a winning margin of over 20 points a game.
Winters 14 for 16 for 162 yards. That one to Trevor Scales on the ground for a first down to the 30-yard line. Another first down for Harvard. Jordan Haynes again on the stop, but a lot of his stops, unfortunately, have come after big gains by Harvard, unfortunately for Yale.
Well, and Yale has to control what's going on up front because they've got a senior-laden defensive line with Stoller and Moran and others. They should be able to control the line of scrimmage, but Harvard's offensive line, one of the real strengths of the team, even though they only have one senior, the left tackle, Kevin Murphy.
Another one of these five receiver sets. Last time they went to Zach Bowden, who's back in the game. This time Winters is going to try to pull it down and run it himself. Nobody open, and gets a nice gain to about the 21-yard line where he's run out of bounds by Kurt Stottlemyre. Boy, when you've got the versatility, when you've got five receivers out to just pull it down and run with it, that's not bad.
Well, and you see Alan Davis, the defensive end, he has contained, and I'm sure they worked on it all week. You can't let Winters get outside of you. But it's one thing to work on it all week. It's a totally different thing when you actually see the speed and quickness of a quarterback like Winters.
Winters already has 207 yards of total offense, rushing and passing. This one he just has to get rid of. Over the head of Zach Bowden, Alan Davis, number 45. I think he had him by the ankle. But Winters manages to avoid the sack and bring up third and two.
Really a good job by Winters just getting rid of the football. And that'll show up on the stat sheet when you look at it tomorrow in the paper as an incompletion. That's a great play. You know, sometimes an incompletion is a great play because if he takes the sack there, that really puts him in a bad spot for third down. Now they have third and two and really have a myriad of options.
And Yale really needs a stop here. Trailing 14 to 7 already. High snap. Messy exchange. Bowden ends up with it and ends up with a first down. That didn't begin very promisingly for Harvard, but it ended with enough yardage for the first down. Drew Baldwin on the stop.
Look how high the snap was. Winters able to get it, barely able to get the ball to Bowden. Bowden makes one guy miss, puts his head down. Even when things go wrong for Harvard, they go right, if that makes sense.
Crimson now 4 for 5 on third down. They started this back on the 13-yard line, if you recall. There's a pump fake by Winters. He throws it up in the corner, incomplete, intended for Lordich. Kurt Stottlemyre, number 6, with the coverage.
Chris Lordich.
You can see early on, Harvard keeps throwing at Kurt Stottlemyre, the junior cornerback. Of course, on the other side, you've got Drew Baldwin, the senior and 3-year starter, one of the better cover corners in the Ivy League. Looks to me like Harvard, thus far, trying to avoid Baldwin and go to the other side, pick on Stottlemyre.
That's Trevor Scales behind Winters. Gets the fake, the pass complete to Adam Chrisis, number 81, to the right side. And that's enough for another first down. The chains move again.
Winters again with that fake. We've probably seen that 20 times, it seems like, already today. And then just gets the ball out there to Chrisis. Coverage was a little soft there by Drew Baldwin.
Yeah, that time they threw at Baldwin. And successfully. First and goal from the 7. Harvard trying to pour it on, and Winters is going to keep it himself. To the 5-yard line, a pickup of only a couple.
You know, it's interesting, with so much talk about whether or not Harvard would be motivated and comparing that to Yale's motivation, maybe there's something to be said for there's no pressure on Harvard. I mean, they've already won the Ivy League outright. They've beaten Yale every other year. Whereas the Yale Bulldogs, especially the seniors, they do not want to graduate from Yale without beating Harvard. Maybe there's more pressure on Yale. There's a lot to be said for that as well, I think.
Yale has lost to Harvard 9 of the last 10 meetings between these teams. There's an interesting play. It's a fake. Winter still has it. Overthrown, intended for Scales. It'll bring up 3rd and goal from the 5.
Excellent job by the Yale defense. Take a look at it. Winters doesn't have anywhere to throw. He wanted Matt Brown. He's not open. Then he was looking at Chrisis. Chrisis wasn't open. Then he overshot Scales. Good coverage by Yale. Give some credit where it's due.
The Yale crowd of 50,000 plus imploring the Bulldogs for a big stop here on 3rd and goal from the 5. Again, this 5 wide receiver set with Zach Bowden, the freshman, in the slot to the left, and Winters will call a timeout.
Timeout, Harvard. First charge timeout. This will be a media timeout.
So Winters will go and talk it over with Tim Murphy. 6:55 left in the half. Harvard up 14-7.
The spake is drying. Helmet. Beer. Foster's, Australian for beer.
$100 for a pair of jeans? Give me a break. I wear Lee Premium Select because they fit, they're comfortable, and they cost less than $50. And according to studies, I've been told they make my butt look good. Researcher.
Getting comfortable never looked so good.
It's easy to see what Subaru owners care about. That's why we created the Share the Love event. Get a great deal on a new Subaru, and $250 goes to your choice of 5 charities. With your help, we can reach $20 million by the end of this, our 4th year.
Cornell, Dartmouth, Harvard, Penn, Princeton, and Yale, synonymous with academic and athletic excellence. The Ivies have the broadest intercollegiate programs in the country. That means more teams, sports, and student athletes than any other intercollegiate athletic conference. These men and women combine national competitive success with the best academic records in the NCAA. Experience the Ivy League yourself at IvyLeagueSports.com.
The Mountain West and the Pac-12 on Versus. Colorado State at TCU next, followed by Colorado at UCLA at 7:30. College football on Versus.
Welcome back to what could be one of the biggest defensive plays of the game for the Yale Bulldogs. Harvard with a 3rd and goal from the 5, already up 14-7. And we got a full house backfield. Trevor Scales is back there. Zach Bowden is back there. And Yale didn't exactly like what they saw back there.
Timeout. Yale. This will be the first charge timeout. This will be a 30-second timeout.
All right, Ross, you think they took a look at that offensive set and said, uh-uh?
Yeah, I think that's exactly what happened. They wanted to see what Harvard wanted to come out with. They came out with the full house backfield, like you said, Randy, and they said, you know what? Let's hit a timeout here. Let's make sure we know what all the options might be off of this play. They want to have their defense set because you said it. This is a really important play early in this game. Obviously, Yale has had an average season. Harvard's been dominant. Yale knows how detrimental it could be to their hopes if they get down by two touchdowns here in the second quarter.
Meanwhile, on January the 2nd, we will officially become part of the NBC Sports family. Versus becomes the NBC Sports Network, a new 24-hour sports network. The NBC Sports Network coming your way January 2nd. Coming your way right now. A key third and goal from the 5. After dueling timeouts. And again, a full house backfield. Winters is going to throw it, and it's incomplete, intended over the middle for Cameron Brate, one of those tight ends. Couldn't make the connection.
They got what they wanted, but watch Winters. After the fake to Scales, he looks right at Brate and throws it, but he threw it before Brate was ready for it. If Winters would have been able to hesitate just a half a second more, that would have been an easy touchdown. But Winters felt like he had to get the ball out of his hands before Brate was even able to get his head around.
So the Bulldogs holding on third and goal, and now the Crimson will try a 22-yard field goal. David Mothender, perfect 8-for-8 in his career from inside the 30, and it's a fake. And the kicker is going to carry it in. Mothender for the touchdown. The holder, Colton Chappell, the backup quarterback, with an option-style pitch to the kicker, the 6'3", 185-pound sophomore from San Juan Capistrano, California. How about that one?
That is a gutsy call by Tim Murphy, but these are the type of plays you save for the Harvard-Yale game. Pitches off the one man, Colin Bibb. There's nobody else out there for Yale. That's why that play was successful. Clearly caught the Bulldogs off guard. Fantastic call by Murphy. Gutsy one, but it worked.
And now Mothender gets to kick the extra point. What a call by Tim Murphy, and what execution. An option play on a fake field goal. And it's good for the touchdown run from 5 yards out, capping a 13-play 3 minute and 52 second drive that puts Harvard up 21-7 on Yale in this 128th edition of The Game.
How to fix plumber's butt. Step one, identify the problem. Step two, carefully remove shirt. Step 3. Put on a Duluth long tail tee. Step 4. Double check your work. The Duluth long tail tee. 3 inches longer to keep you covered. Get one at DuluthTrading.com.
Do you have an idea for an invention or new product? Bill Schaefer, co-inventor of the Splash Wash, did. He came up with the idea while watching his children play. And Ben helped submitted his idea to Whammo, maker of toys like the Frisbee and Hula Hoop. To find out how InventHelp can help you try to submit your idea to companies, call for free information. Bill Schaefer made a financial gain with his invention. Bill's experience is not typical, and most inventions are not successful.
For your free inventor's information, call 1-800-219-9905.
So has anybody actually started saving for college yet?
Oh, not me.
No, you got time.
Oh, no, we actually started.
Yeah, but how did you even know where to start?
Oh, I found out about the Gerber Life College Plan.
Call now and get started with free information on the Gerber Life College Plan.
Oh, it's a life insurance policy, too.
Oh, that's different.
It's pretty much where I agree.
No matter what happens, we get guaranteed safe growth.
We've got to get started.
Call 1-800-764-4560 for your free information.
On NFL Turning Point, Mark Sanchez and the Jets called a costly timeout, and the Patriots seized the opportunity. NFL Turning Point with Dan Patrick, tonight at 11 on Versus.
Welcome back to Ivy League Football on Versus, where Harvard has just deflated the crowd of 50,000 plus here at the Yale Bowl with that fake field goal run by David Mothender to put the Crimson up 21-7.
Third straight year, special teams have had a major impact in this game. 2 years ago, it was the unsuccessful fake punt on 4th and 22 by Yale, Last year, it was the kickoff return for a touchdown to start the second half by Marco Iannuzzi, which really got Harvard going. Today, it's the blocked field goal by Splinter and the fake field goal to Mothender.
And there was a blocked punt last year as well in the second half that led to a key touchdown. So special teams front and center in this matchup in favor of Harvard the last few years. Harvard had a string of 500-yard offensive games snapped last week at Penn. They've already got 278 yards of total offense, and we played a little more than a quarter and a half. Gio Christodoulou with the kick by Mothender from the 6-yard line. Christodoulou met at the 31-yard line by Chris Splinter again, number one, the young man who blocked the field goal a little earlier.
I mentioned the key plays on special teams. This is the blocked kick by Splinter. And then you see the fake field goal. Only one Yale Bulldog out there. You can tell that Yale really did not think that that was coming. And you know what? Neither did I. I don't blame him, but you always have to be prepared.
So Yale begins 69 yards from the end zone. Patrick Witt intended for Keith Cody, the tight end, incomplete on first down from the 31-yard line. Witt, of course, has been in the news all week long. He was a Rhodes Scholar candidate, had an interview scheduled in Atlanta today, the same day as the Harvard-Yale game, decided to forego the Rhodes process for now. He can always go back and reapply, I think until he's 24 years old, which may be an option. He also wants to play in the NFL at some point next year. That's a pass complete to Deion Randall, but for only about a yard.
Well, and I think Patrick Witt will get an opportunity, at least in a mini camp or in a training camp, as you see Tom Williams there, Yale's head coach.
And Tom Williams, of course, has been in the news. Yale is actually investigating his resume, which says that he was a Rhodes Scholar candidate himself. He elaborated this week that he was actually, when he was at Stanford, a faculty advisor told him that they would encourage him to apply for a Rhodes Scholarship, but that he never went through the process. So that's been a bit of a mini controversy as a result of a New York Times story this week. On third and 10, Patrick Witt over the middle to Cameron Sandquist. But it's going to be short of the first down to the 38-yard line, and Yale is going to punt it away. That's not what they needed.
No, tough spot to get a three and out. And if you're ever going to do a fake punt, this would be a decent time to do it. Close to midfield, and you can see some of the Harvard coaches, they are making sure that their players are ready for anything that they might face on this play. They are clearly prepared for a fake punt.
And they call a timeout as Kyle Cazzetta, the freshman, was ostensibly preparing to kick it away.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
Well, and clearly, they didn't feel like they were prepared enough. I don't blame them. You know, if you're not sure, if you're not settled, and if you have a fear that they might come with a fake punt, that would be a momentum killer for Harvard, which clearly has the momentum right now with the 21 unanswered points. They don't want to take any chances with Yale being able to pull something off on this fourth down play.
Now, a couple of years ago, after Caldwell called for that fourth and 22 fake punt with the lead that backfired, you think he still has a fake punt in his playbook versus Harvard?
I think he does. I think fourth and three, you got a much better shot than fourth and 22. Fourth and 22 is pretty tough.
John Powers carried the ball for 15 yards. Didn't make the first down a couple of years ago in a very controversial call that wound up in a Harvard touchdown. Cazzetta had a 61-yard punt a little earlier with the wind. Now it appears this is against the wind. It's kind of hard to tell. And that one is going to come down to Scott Miller, who is swarmed immediately at about the 30-yard line.
It was fielded by 25, Scott Miller.
So Harvard is closing in on 300 yards of total offense. 5 minutes to play in the second half, or the first half, and Harvard leads by 2 touchdowns.
Oh, oh, oh.
Oh, look, honey, it's Santa.
I thought I heard reindeer.
Mom, I mean, Mrs. Nelson, I have the perfect gift for you.
You must have gotten my letter.
Santa.
Levion Jewelry, featuring Levion Chocolate Diamonds at Kay Jewelers. Levion, one more reason Kay is the number one jewelry store in America.
These are for me, right?
Every kiss begins with K.
Capital One's new cash rewards card gives you a 50% annual bonus, so you earn 50% more cash. If you're not satisfied with 50% more cash, send it back. I'll be right here waiting for it. Who wouldn't want more cash? I'll take it. I'll make it rain up in here.
The new Capital One Cash Rewards Card. The card for people who want 50% more cash.
What's in your wallet? Sorry, I'll clean this up. Shouldn't have made it rain.
Walter Camp.
Yale.
John Heisman.
Penn.
Pop Warner.
Cornell.
American football was born in the Ivy League. With 53 national champions, 3 Heisman Trophy winners, and an honor roll of national leaders and NFL stars, its campuses are the gold standard for academic and athletic achievement. The 8 Ivy League schools built a game. Tradition lives here.
We are back. There's a look at linebacker William Vaughn, the freshman from New Jersey for Yale, as the Bulldogs are on the sideline right there a moment ago talking about how to stop this Harvard juggernaut. History lesson. The oldest consecutively played rivalries in college football. Kansas-Missouri checks in at number 5. William and Mary and Richmond at number 4. You're looking at the number 3 oldest consecutively played rivalry in college football, Harvard-Yale. Number 2, Princeton-Yale. And what do you think is number 1?
I know what's number 1. Lehigh Lafayette. I'm from Reading, Pennsylvania. I know all about Lehigh Lafayette. It's being played today as well.
147 meetings between those two fine institutes of higher learning. On first down, that pass from Winters incomplete. Kyle Juszczyk couldn't quite hang on to it.
Well, Yale needs one of two things here in the worst way. A turnover, obviously, would be fantastic. But at a minimum, they need to stop them. Look at the yards that Harvard has already. And there's still over 5 minutes here in the second quarter.
Some of those yards have been picked up by the freshman, Zach Bowden. That's him, and that's a loss. Subtract a couple from Bowden's yardage total. Loss of 2. Dawson Holliday, number 4.
Excellent play call by Yale defensive coordinator Ikaika Malloy. He brings Holliday, the cornerback, off the edge. So, of course, when he comes off the edge on the corner blitz, he's going to be unblocked. You're rolling the dice a little bit that's the play call, but they felt like they knew the run was coming, and Holliday made the play.
3rd and 12. Holliday now a cornerback. He's a former quarterback. Here's Winters over the middle, complete to Juszczyk. That's a first down over the 45-yard line. And the Harvard offensive juggernaut continues to roll. First down to the 46.
Man, these two guys are such weapons. You'll see him coming from the right side of your screen. He just pops in at the very end. He was working against Colin Bibb. Really impressive. These two tight ends for Harvard, they're both about 6'4", 6'5", 230, 240 pounds. What weapons to be able to split them out like Juszczyk is right there and have them run these wide receiver routes.
And let's see if Sarkisian can pass. He's already thrown a touchdown pass, caught a touchdown pass. That intended for Matt Brown. Overthrown and incomplete, but he was well covered.
He was very well covered. You see this? It's a backward pass, so Sarkisian's able to throw a forward pass, but Drew Baldwin, number 1, top right of your screen, he didn't fall for it. He was all over Matt Brown. Usually, a guy like Sarkisian wouldn't even throw it if the coverage was that good. He'd tuck it away and see what kind of positive yardage he can get.
On 2nd and 10, Winters is forced to keep it under pressure. Gets back to about the line of scrimmage where Austin Pulsifer, the only married member of the Yale Bulldog team, makes the stop. He was a freshman back in 2006 and took a couple of years off for a mission trip. He's a Mormon. He went to Taiwan, speaks Mandarin Chinese. 3rd and 10. Winters throws it up. Lordich, some contact there. The pass incomplete. Drew Baldwin was down there on the coverage. Let's go back down to Carolyn.
Randy, you mentioned Austin Pulsifer. He not only is he the only married guy on the squad, he's also the only member of Yale's team that has a championship ring. You mentioned the two-year Mormon trip that he took. He was here in 2006 when Yale split a share of that Ivy title. So he has a ring, and he also has a wife to go along with it. Back to you, Randy.
He has more than one ring. So a very key stop there by the Yale defense. Jacob Domrowski will punt it away. And that gets a Harvard roll, and it is down inside the 5-yard line by Dan Minamidi. So Yale in the hole on the field and on the scoreboard.
Most legroom per dollar of any car in America. The all-new Nissan Versa sedan from $10,990. Innovation upsized. Innovation for all.
There's a reason our KFC Famous Bowl is famous. Okay, 5 reasons. Layered together for what might be the world's best tasting full meal. How do we make that recipe even more famous?
We put bacon on it.
Wow. Another one for the Colonel. Introducing the new KFC Cheesy Bacon Bowl. Try it right now for only $3.99.
Everything's better with bacon.
No argument here, Rachel. Today's a KFC day. Today tastes so good.
USA Prime Credit. My name Peggy. You have problem?
Peggy? Okay. Lost my card. Need a replacement sent to my hotel tomorrow.
1 month.
Let's try this again. Do you believe in yourself?
Yes.
I believe in you too, Peggy. You could be my go-to guy.
Or girl.
Now stand tall and get out to replace my card.
You inspire me. 3 weeks.
Okay, let's start over.
Want better customer service? Switch to Discover. Ranked number one in customer loyalty. It pays to Discover.
Montreal's PK Subban and Carey Price anchor one of the toughest back ends in the East. But Boston is armed with their own young guns. Bruins Canadiens. Coverage begins Monday at 6:30 on Versus.
This may be one of the most traditional of all football venues, the Yale Bowl, but right now the wave has erupted throughout the crowd of approximately 50,000. This place is a slice of Americana. This place has quite the history. And Yale would like to make a little history by reversing the tide against Harvard. They've lost 9 of the last 10. Patrick Witt is in trouble in the end zone. He's going to run it out on first down from the 2-yard line. And Witt actually gets first down yardage to the 14, not known for being fleet of foot, but Witt got the job done there. John Mason ran him out.
He's really improved in that area. He really has. Take a look at Patrick Witt. They were going for a 98, 99-yard touchdown. Nobody was open. Good movement skills in the pocket. Been able to get the first down. I actually thought that they might call a late hit at the very tail end of that play. He got hit by Bobby Schneider.
On first down, Witt looking for somebody to throw to and does dump it off complete to Deion Randall, the sophomore, Yale's leading receiver. Came into this game with 41 catches on the season. Alex Gideon on the stop. Second and 4 now. Complete and a great catch by Cameron Sandquist for first down yardage. Harvard is trying to say incomplete. The ball hit the ground, but the officials say no.
Remember, there's no replay in the Ivy League, so whatever the officials say on the field is what it is, and Yale's got something going here.
To the 41-yard line. That was a pickup of 28, but that one bounced from Witt to Jackson LaCorey. Incomplete.
Take one more look at it. Little quarter roll by Witt. Throws the deep post to Sandquist. Looks to me at first glance like he did catch it. You see both hands outstretch and grab it. And really at this point it's immaterial.
So it'll be second and 10. Here's a name we haven't called yet. Josue Ortiz. the sensational defensive tackle for Harvard has so far been a non-factor. Witt has had a lot of time to throw the ball. That one, Alex Thomas, will run to the 45-yard line with the captain of Harvard, Alex Geddie, and the middle linebacker in on the stop. Captain and leading tackler for the Crimson defense. 1:52 and counting as Yale goes into a hurry-up offense. Third and six. A screen to Thomas, and he is caught from behind by Bobby Schneider. Short of the first down, bringing up an interesting decision here.
Wow, they had that set up perfectly, but Bobby Schneider able to chase down and make that play from behind.
Fourth and three, what do you do here?
Well, they're going to call timeout and talk about it.
Second charge timeout.
This will be a 30 the ball second. Spotted on the 48-yard line, Yale's 48-yard line.
Take a look at this one more time. It looks like Alex Thomas is home free, and then Schneider chases him down. Anytime you're chasing a player like that, you want to go right down the line of scrimmage like Schneider did. Thomas had two or three blockers in front of him, had a lot of room to run if he would have been able to get past Schneider, but Schneider did what he was supposed to.
Coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, Liam, Doug, and Roland will take you through all the scores and highlights. Plus, they'll take a look back at last night's upset shocker. Iowa State taking down number two Oklahoma State in double overtime. Again, that's the Geico Halftime Report. Stay right with us. That's coming up next.
I don't know if any of these are shockers anymore. It's happening so often.
Well, that certainly put the BCS in disarray once you get past LSU.
And I tell you what, I wouldn't be surprised if LSU lost to either Arkansas or Georgia.
Now you're talking. That's my Hogs you're talking about there. Fourth and three, they're going for it. We think.
Trying to draw them off sides.
The play clock ticks down, and now we get the flag. Jose Ortiz almost bit.
On the offense. 5 yards from the original line of scrimmage. Remains fourth down.
There's no harm in trying. I actually think when Jose Ortiz flinched a little bit, take a look at the bottom of your screen, bottom left. Watch Jose jump a little bit. The left tackle, Ben Carberry, he's only a freshman. If he would have come out of his stance then, that would have been a penalty against Harvard.
Would have been an encroachment penalty on Harvard, but
neutral zone infraction.
Winds up being a punt by Kyle Cazetta against the wind, and the ball sort of dies out of bounds at about the 33-yard line where Harvard will take over with a minute 23 left in the half. And let's go to our lows building toward the BCS. When you see those rankings there, keep in mind they're unadjusted after Oklahoma State's loss last night. It'll be interesting to see what the new BCS rankings will be.
Well, you're exactly right. Oregon has a big game tonight against USC. Oklahoma playing Baylor. And as I mentioned, I'm telling you right now, I think LSU is going to lose a game. This whole thing is going to be all messed up.
Arkansas plays Mississippi State and then LSU on Thanksgiving week. First down, one timeout remaining. Alex Sarkisian again, the senior, having a big game on the receiving end of that one. It is a first down, so the clock will stop momentarily while the chains move.
One of the benefits of having a no huddle is that you're so comfortable when you have to go into your two-minute offense.
Good point. Winters hits the tight end, Cameron Brate. Does not get out of bounds. The ball to near midfield. We're inside a minute now. And again, Harvard does have one timeout remaining. That's 18 first downs on that last play. Play before last on that first down. Mark the 18th of the game so far for Harvard. Second and short. That one overthrown, intended for 87. Brate once again. Jeff Dunham on the coverage. Clock stopped with 47 seconds remaining in the half.
Another score for Harvard would be dominating for Jordan Haynes and his Yale defense. That'd be absolutely devastating, and it'd be domination by Harvard if that were to happen. They need to make a play here on D.
Winters just dumps it off, and it's good for a first down. That's the freshman, Zach Bowden, who's shown his prowess not just running the football, but catching it out of the backfield as well.
Way too much time for Collier Winters on that play.
We're at 30 seconds now. First down. Complete to the sideline and out of bounds. Kyle Juszczyk, the tight end, to about the 31. Check that. That's the 36-yard line.
And if you're Yale, it's one thing to allow Juszczyk to catch that ball. It's another thing to allow him to get out of bounds. You should have outside leverage against the edge receivers and tackle them in the field of play.
And keep in mind, they are going with the win if it comes down to a David Mothender field goal. Complete for a big gain. Cameron Brake, the tight end. They missed him on the left sideline a couple of plays ago. That one complete. Jeff Dunham on the stop. 22 seconds remaining.
Again, Winters had all kinds of time. Then he was flushed to the right side. Brake wide open. Harvard's in business again.
A quarterback draw from Winters. They have a timeout left. Remember, he's inside the 5-yard line. And they use that timeout with 9 seconds on the clock. They've got time for one more play.
Timeout, Harvard. It's a final timeout. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
Again, the designed run inside the red zone. Teams like this so much. You get a good block from Murphy, not able to score, which sets him up here second down and goal from the 4. But without any timeouts and 9 seconds left, I'd be very surprised if they ran the ball again. And in fact, I would expect one shot in the end zone, Collier Winters knowing he can't scramble around, he can't get sacked, has to throw the ball into the end zone. But he also, Randy, has to reserve the right to kick a field goal. Because the worst case scenario for Harvard right now is a turnover or not at least getting a field goal attempt off. Because even if they just get a field goal, they'll be up by 17, which would put them up 3 scores, which is huge.
So Cameron Winter, Collier Winters in the offense. You've got that full house backfield again with not just Bowden and Scales, but also Kyle Juszczyk, the tight end, who is lined up to Winters' left, immediate left. And Juszczyk now goes in motion. Winters, trying to avoid the sack, throws it out of the back of the end zone. That was very nearly what Harvard didn't want to happen.
Well, and that's why he's a fifth-year senior, and that's why he's such a smart quarterback, because it wasn't there, nobody was open, and it looked like Pataglia was about to sack him, but Kyrie Winters loves football, wants to stay in football in some capacity when it's over. He was smart enough to realize, I got to get this ball out of our hands so Mothender can attempt this field goal.
A 22-yard field goal. This is about the same spot on the field where they ran the fake a little earlier, but I think they've used that one up now. With the win from a slight angle, and Mothender kicks it through. To end the first half, and it has been a half of Harvard domination. They've already won 9 of the last 10 meetings against Yale. They've won 7 out of their last 8 here at the Yale Bowl. And at halftime, they'll take a 24-7 lead into the locker room. Let's go down to the field to Carolyn.
Coach, your fast-paced offense has seemed to work. What have you been particularly pleased with through the first half?
Well, we've converted in the red zone. We've done a great job in the red zone all year long. We made a big play, obviously, on the fake field goal. Kids are doing a good job.
Gutsy call by you. What inspired that fake field goal?
What inspired me is the call's mine, but the special teams guys did a great job scheming it.
Coach, thank you very much. Good luck in the second half. Randy and Ross, I think some trick plays are a must on a day like this. Back to you.
Well, we've seen a little bit of everything. We've seen a blocked field goal by Harvard. We've seen a fake field goal by Harvard that resulted in a touchdown and the Crimson lead 24-7 at halftime. Let's go back to Liam now in the Geico halftime report.
Welcome to the Geico halftime report on Versus.
Hey everyone, Liam McHugh alongside Doug Flutie and Roland Williams. Yale Harvard, it is the game, a game so important that Yale's Patrick Wick chose to quarterback his team rather than interview for a Rhodes Scholarship today. But so far, the difference of this one has not been the signal callers. It's been special teams.
You know, Yale came out inspired, scored first, but since then, 24 straight points by Harvard, and special teams played a key in this. I mean, you know, Yale wants to stay in this game. You can't make these mistakes. Block for a field goal. Boom, Harvard gets through. Big block field goal there when it was a competitive game. And then the fake field goal, instead of getting three, Harvard walks in the end zone, picks up another seven. 24 unanswered points.
Let's move on from the Ivy League and hit up some early highlights from around the country. Let's begin in that other SEC division, the East, with the Georgia Bulldogs looking to punch their ticket to the SEC title game. Aaron Murray, he's already broken Matt Stafford's single-season touchdown pass record. First quarter, though, it's Kentucky, Maxwell Smith to Matt Rourke.
This was pretty amazing. This team is 118th in the FBS in total offense, making plays early.
Scary moment here for Georgia. Freshman running back Isaiah Crowell injures his ankle, had to limp off the field, but then it's Smith to Tyler Robinson, and it's 10-6 Kentucky.
Did I tell you this team was 118th in FBS in offense and is winning against Georgia right now? This is why they play the game.
Georgia looking to take care of the business at home, and they're not doing so far. Let's move on. Indiana, Michigan State. Kirk Cousins, the all-time winningest QB in Michigan State history, trying to lead the Spartans to a perfect record at home for the second straight year. So he's looking for B.J. Cunningham, and he's faking out even the camera.
Boy, operator. He sold that fake, and Cunningham had time to make a double move and get open deep.
More from Cousins this time. Plenty of time, and he finds Keyshawn Martin, and then Indiana.
Nice tackling, but you said it. It's plenty of time to throw the football, both off the first play action and the hard fake in the second one as well.
Cousins putting on a show. Michigan State can clinch the Legends Division with a win and a Nebraska loss. Speaking of the Cornhuskers, number 16 Nebraska, number 18 Michigan, a matchup of two of the best running quarterbacks in the game, Denard Robinson and Nebraska's Taylor Martinez. But in the first quarter, it's Taylor Martinez airing it out and finding Brandon Kinney.
We don't like his throwing motion, but when you got that kind of time, you can wind up and throw the football. Michigan is making Martinez throw the ball.
Here, though, it's Robinson doing what he does best, keeping it on the ground.
He struggled early, and then he decided, the heck with this, I'm going to run the football. And he did what he does best, take off and run.
At the half, Michigan leads it 17-10. Robinson, though, 98 yards. He does have another interception to go along with 75 rushing yards. But Michigan, you'd have to say, doing a pretty good job on defense so far, despite that big play.
They really are. They give you a lot of looks. They run that three down, do a lot of zone blitzing, and they're coming up to stop the run, shutting down the option game in Nebraska, forcing Martinez to throw the football.
And Denard Robinson, he has to stop with these unforced errors. Early in his football game, he missed a few throws. He threw an interception for the season. 13 touchdowns, 13 INTs. Every time he does something good, he goes back. He uses feet, which is great, a la Tim Tebow, but you want to see him complete some passes. Right now, they're playing better in Nebraska, but the score doesn't look that way.
I love Denard, though, come fourth quarter.
Yeah, he's a big-time player late in every game. Still to come, a double overtime upset in Ames cost Cowboys a shot at the national title. We'll take a look back at last night's Big 12 BCS buster. That's next.
Just for a pair of jeans? Give me a break. I wear Lee Premium Select because they fit, they're comfortable, and they cost less than $50. And according to studies, I've been told they make my butt look good. Researcher.
Getting comfortable never looked so good.
Hey guys, I know I told you that Head & Shoulders for more than dandruff, how it gives me a healthy scalp and great looking hair, but who used mine up?
It was Heinz.
Seriously?
You lying fool.
Head & Shoulders, 7 benefits every bottle.
Feeling vulnerable?
Oh. I bought my car insurance policy online without an agent. Now I feel totally unprotected.
With a local Arbella independent agent, you'll get coverage that, well, covers you. Go to Arbella.com to find an independent agent near you.
Excuse me. The Mountain West and the Pac-12 on Versus. Colorado State at TCU, next. Followed by Colorado at UCLA at 7:30. College football on Versus.
Oh.
Introducing the official training bike of the Tour de France, the ProForm TDF, the first ever indoor training bike that delivers everything you demand. A 20% incline and a 20% decline, so you'll experience exactly what the road does. Because it's powered by Google Maps, you choose the road and the TDF follows it. Every incline and decline, so no matter what comes at you, you'll be ready. The ProForm TDF automatically adjusts resistance, incline and decline. Plus, with a built-in power meter, you'll know your exact output. You decide where to go, and the official training bike of the Tour takes you there. And now that you've decided, we're ready to deliver. Order right now and get zero down and a free upgrade on rush shipping. Call the number on your screen or go online today.
Halftime at Yale. The first installment of the game took place in 1875 during the Ulysses Grant administration. Here in 2011, Harvard leads it 24-7. Prior to today's game, there was a horrific accident at the tailgate. A U-Haul truck accelerated into a small group of people. A 30-year-old woman was killed. Two others were injured. At halftime, a short while ago, a moment of silence was observed. And of course, our thoughts are with the victims and their families. Of course, there is no easy way to transition from news like that back to football. But right now, let's try to get back to the highlights from the early games today. Wisconsin and Illinois, Monty Ball needs three more touchdowns to become the fifth player in NCAA history with 30 TDs in the season. But early on, it was all Illinois. Donovan Young in from 12 yards out, fighting Illini up 7-0. Ensuing drive, Whitney Merciless leads the nation in sacks. And here he introduces himself to Russell Wilson.
You know, the defense for Illinois was playing outstanding. This is a team that's lost four consecutive games, coming to prove something against a big-ranked opponent.
Young would score again after that to put the Illini up 14-0. It is now 17-7. The Badgers under 100 yards at the break. If Wisconsin comes back to win their matchup next week against Penn State, would decide the Big Ten leaders division. To the Big East, Cincinnati Rutgers. Mohamed Sanu broke Larry Fitzgerald's Big East record for catches in a season. He enters state with 94 early in the first, though it's Munchie Lego dropping back. Cassine Green strips him, and Justin Francis is there to pounce. Rutgers has the ball, and two plays later, it's Jawan Jameson, and watch him freeze this defender.
You can't teach this, coach. Little stick to the left, one foot there, straight ahead, right by him. Great quickness.
So Rutgers in the end zone there, 10-3 at the half. The Bearcats just three wins away from a Big East title and a BCS berth. Last night, the number 2-ranked Oklahoma State Cowboys were on the road in Ames, Iowa. The same day, a profound and horribly familiar sadness had settled over Stillwater. On Thursday, Oklahoma State women's basketball coach Kurt Budke and assistant Miranda Serna were killed along with two other people in a single-engine plane crash on their way to a recruiting trip in Arkansas. You might recall that nearly a decade ago, a plane carrying players and staff from the school's men's basketball team crashed in Colorado, killing all 10 on board. In the game between Oklahoma State and Iowa State, a moment of silence was observed for Budke and Serna. Pick it up in the second quarter. Brandon Whedon to Justin Blackman. He makes a move. He's in the end zone, and it is 17-7. But Iowa State battled back. They would tie it in the fourth quarter. Jared Barnett to Albert Gary, who goes down and gets it. This one goes to a second overtime. It's Whedon looking for Blackman. The pass tipped, and it is picked by Teron Benton. Iowa State would then hand the ball to Jeff Woody, and he seals the deal. The Cyclones shocked the second-ranked Cowboys 37-31. They had never beaten a top-five team in their 120 seasons. Whedon had big numbers, 476 yards, three touchdowns, but those three interceptions cost his team perfection and likely cost him the Heisman in the BCS. LSU is 10-0. Everyone else in the top 10 has a loss. So, guys, it seems more and more likely that the BCS title game is going to feature a rematch of some sort. The question, of course, is who should get that shot at a rematch? Should it be one-loss Alabama, or should it be one-loss Oregon? Roe.
I think you guys know what I'm going to choose. The game is a rematch between LSU and Alabama. Everybody that watched that football game, for all intents and purposes, Alabama played, outplayed LSU. They rushed for more yards, they passed for more yards, but they missed four field goals, and then you saw the tight end with a play. I think that's the game everyone wants to see. It might be a little bit boring, However, I think the national championship should be the best team versus the second team in college football, and that's who they are unless LSU loses.
You know, I agree with you 100%, brother. Alabama's the team with one loss right now that is in that position. I agree. They still have to get by Auburn now, so that may not happen. But if you, the alternative would be Oregon. Oregon is a flashier team, a much improved team. They did lose to LSU badly first week of the season. They've gotten healthy again here late in the year, making a run. They're going for style points now, and they're playing much better on defense. Shoot, last week against Stanford, 7-3 and outs versus Stanford. They've done a great job of rotating a lot of people in. They're getting stronger and stronger. They can make a statement.
Of course, things could get very interesting next week if Arkansas beats LSU. Then Arkansas would have beaten LSU. LSU would have beaten Alabama, and Alabama would have beaten Arkansas. And then we can have this discussion again. Up ahead, the Fighting Irish are back in the top 25 and searching for a seventh win in their last eight games. We'll look ahead to the Catholic Bowl, Notre Dame, and Boston College. That's next.
You want to save money on car insurance? No problem. You want to save money on RV insurance? No problem. You want to save money on motorcycle insurance? No problem. You want to find a place to park all these things? Forget about it. This is New York.
Hey, little guy, wake up.
Oh, calm off it, Mike.
Geico. Saving people money on more than just car insurance.
A place of dialogue and discovery, where tomorrow's leaders come from all corners of the world to collaborate and to be challenged, to contribute, and to be inspired. Yale University, setting the standard in the 21st century for a university in service to the world. Visit us in New Haven or online at yale.edu.
Succeeding in today's market requires more than wishful thinking. It requires determination and decisive action. I go to E-Trade and get unbiased analyst ratings and 24/7 help from award-winning customer support to take control of my finances and my life. I tap into the power of revolutionary mobile apps to trade wherever, whenever. Life isn't fully experienced sitting idly by. Neither is investing.
You're watching the Geico Halftime Report on Versus. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com for a free rate quote. Notre Dame, which has won seven of its last eight games, including two straight at the expense of the ACC, returned to the top 25 this week. But today's game is about much more than a return to respectability. For Michael Floyd and the rest of the team's seniors, it's about celebrating their careers with the Fighting Irish. Here's Alex Flanagan.
Liam, later today, an opportunity to see two of the best inside linebackers in college football in Notre Dame's Manti Te'o and Boston College's Luke Kuechly. Meanwhile, 39 seniors will be honored here today in Notre Dame's final home game of the season, including wide receiver Michael Floyd, who will be on this field with his mother, Teresa Romero.
Getting this degree from one of the best universities in the country to my mom, you know, she'll be jumping for joy. Just because it's a experience that she never lived, and she's kind of living, you know, vicariously through me, and she wants me to be a successful person, and to get that degree in my hand, it meant a lot to her.
It's likely to be an emotional day for many of the Notre Dame players as they welcome Boston College here at Notre Dame Stadium. See the game at 4 o'clock Eastern on NBC.
We look forward to the Irish and the Eagles, and a reminder that at 3:30 Eastern, Colorado State takes on TCU, and later tonight on Versus, that game's on Versus, as is coverage of Colorado and UCLA. That begins at 7 p.m. Eastern. As for our current game, it is halftime of Harvard and Yale, and we'll send you out to second half action right after this.
This has been the Geico Halftime Report on Versus.
Okay, you know you're gonna need new tires. It's inevitable, right? So why not get them from TireRack.com? With TireRack's online research tools, you'll know you're getting exactly the right tires for you, your car, and the way you drive it, all at a great price. Don't just change your tires, change the way you buy tires. The biggest selection of tires. One more way TireRack is revolutionizing the way you buy tires. TireRack Stack.com. Research, buy, deliver, install.
I wouldn't do that.
Get married?
No, I wouldn't use that single miles credit card. Nice ring. Knock it off. Ignore him.
With the Capital One Venture Card, you earn
double miles on every purchase.
3D is so real, Larry.
I'm right here, Larry. If you're not earning double miles, you're settling for half.
Really?
A plaid tie? What are we, in prep school?
Get the Venture Card at CapitalOne.com and earn double miles on every purchase every day.
What's in your wallet? I was gonna say that.
The NHL is on versus. Monday, Sagan leads the Bruins into Montreal against Subban and the Canadiens. Tuesday, Kopitar and the Kings battle the Blues. Next week, the NHL is on versus.
Feeling buried by all the piles of paper in your home or office? Maybe it's time you traded in the old filing cabinet for a new office assistant. Meet the NeatDesk Scanner and Organizer, the only scanner that actually thinks while it scans. With NeatDesk, all your important documents can be easily scanned and then organized with the NeatWork software, so that shoebox full of receipts instantly becomes a manageable expense report. That stack of business cards can go directly into your computer's contact list. Virtually any piece of paper automatically becomes a searchable document that you can find with a simple keyword. And here's the best part. If you call or visit us at tryneat.com right now, you can use the Neat Desk or the amazing Neat Portable Scanner for 30 days absolutely free. That's right, you'll have one full month to enjoy a paper-free lifestyle absolutely free. That's how confident we are that you'll love your Neat Organizer. So give us a call or go to tryneat.com for your 30-day trial and say goodbye to all that paper.
At halftime here in New Haven, Connecticut, Harvard sporting a 17-point lead over Yale. And coincidentally, so far this season, the Crimson's average margin of victory in the Ivy League, 17.7 points. We take a look at our Foster's first half stats, and Ross, they're one-sided as well.
Yeah, and we mentioned several times the last couple games Yale has really dominated, even though they didn't win. Can't say that today. It's been all Harvard in the first half, and the one thing that doesn't even show up on those first half stats is the fake field goal, which got a crucial touchdown for the Crimson.
That was the Foster's first half stats. Now, in case you just joined us this morning, a tragedy occurred just outside the Yale Bowl here in which a young woman lost her life. For an update on that, let's go downstairs to Carolyn Mano.
Well, Randy, as you mentioned, three people involved hit by a U-Haul on Yale's D lot, which is about 500 yards from the Yale Bowl. Police have confirmed that the victim who lost her life is 30 years old and from Massachusetts. Now, reports here say that a U-Haul was pulling into that D lot and that the car accelerated for really no reason, ended up hitting two other U-Hauls. And of the three people that were hurt, the other two are in the hospital right now. One is said to have minor injuries. The other is said to have been stable. But condition, although it is a serious condition, you can find updates on news.yale.edu. The university is making the latest updates available. The families are being contacted, and the driver of that U-Haul has been taken to police station for questioning. Randy?
All right, thanks, Carolyn. A terribly unfortunate beginning to this rivalry Saturday here in New Haven. We'll be back for the second half kickoff of Harvard versus Yale after this.
The most headroom per dollar of any car in America. The all-new Nissan Versa sedan from $10,990. Innovation upsized. Innovation for all.
My father and I sweat a lot. The towel over his shoulder became associated with him. And so I wasn't going to have a towel over my shoulder. My mom calls me and she says, look, I know you don't want to throw that towel over your shoulder because your dad did, but you're sweating like a mule. You look disgusted. Do something. My name is John Thompson, and I am definitely comfortable in my own skin.
Walter Camp.
Yale.
John Heisman.
Penn.
Pop Warner.
Cornell.
American football was born in the Ivy League. With 53 national champions, three Heisman Trophy winners, and an honor roll of national leaders and NFL stars, its campuses are the gold standard for academic and athletic achievement. The eight Ivy League schools built a game. Tradition lives here.
Welcome to Longhorn Steakhouse, where for a limited time you can enjoy our new lobster stuffed filet. It's Longhorn's juicy filet, perfectly grilled outside, topped with a garlic crusted half lobster tail, and stuffed with succulent lobster. Or tonight, try our tender filet, stuffed with aged white cheddar and savory bacon. Right now, only at Longhorn Steakhouse, discover the West in you. And now, discover new lunch combinations starting at just $7.99.
Welcome back to the Yale Bowl. As you see, Collier Winters there, the senior quarterback for Harvard, warming up in advance of the second half. This is a series that has been dominated the past decade by Harvard, and at least in the first half, we've seen more of the same. Patrick Witt has played well for Yale, but right now the Harvard offense has rolled up 357 yards of total offense in two quarters of play, Ross.
Yeah, and the good news for Yale is twofold. Number one, they get the ball here to start the second half. Number two, they have a quarterback in Patrick Witt who clearly has the physical skill set to be able to put a lot of points on the board in a hurry.
And Witt has actually been getting time to throw the ball, but they just haven't been able to put any points on the board. Right, as we begin the second half, David Mothender, number 37, the sophomore kicker for Harvard, who had a touchdown run on a fake field goal in the second quarter, will tee it up. And that's Gio Christodoulou, Yale's all-time leading punt returner, who's been pressed into action as a kickoff returner due to the injury of Chris Smith, the explosive wide receiver and kick returner for Yale, who has a hamstring problem and is missing the game.
Gio Christodoulou.
And let's get underway in the second half. Christodoulou backed all the way to the 1 yard line. Excellent coverage by the Harvard special teams. Only a 15 yard return by Christodoulou, number 99, the freshman Zach Hodges, in on the tackle. So let's see what Yale can get going here. They'll start from their 18.
Well, I don't want to say it's now or never, because that's just not true, but you got to think, if you're Yale, it's critical that they get some points on the board on this drive. They got to start this second half out strong and try to turn the tide a little bit.
And they'll start it off with Deion Randall on a little trickery. They try to get him the ball as much as possible. But that was sniffed out pretty well by Alex Norman, the linebacker, number 46, and others for a short gain.
Well, we saw Alexander Norman make a couple great plays last week against Penn. Watch how athletic he is. He's going to be number 46 right in the middle of your screen. Watch him chase down Deion Randall, going flat down the line of scrimmage, meets him at the junction point. What an athlete he is for an outside linebacker.
Randall will sometimes line up in the shotgun as a Wildcat quarterback. That's Alex Thomas, leading rusher for Yale. Held mostly in check in the first half. Gets to about the 25-yard line, where it'll bring up third down and about two or three.
It's weird, Randy, because we just talked about Patrick Witt. He's been having time to throw. He's been fairly accurate. They've run the ball decently, but they're losing by 17 points. I mean, you can't point anything offensively. It's been a play here and a play there where they failed to convert in situations like this.
Witt at 6'4", senior from Atlanta, third and three. Deion Randall comes out of the backfield to make the catch. Eludes a tackler and gets the first down to about the 29-yard line. Alex Gedeon, the middle linebacker, the captain, the senior on the stop. Bobby Schneider also involved.
Deion Randall, just a little flare pattern. He's the check down for Witt. Watch that. That's all you needed right there. He made Schneider miss. That quick little cut enabled him to get the first down yardage. That's one thing you can do when a linebacker's got that much momentum flying at you.
Some movement on the line
70 on the offense. 5 yards from the original line of scrimmage. First down.
That's the freshman left tackle, number 70, Ben Carberry, promoted to the first string after the injury to sophomore Wes Gavin.
You'll see him just rock back in his stance just a little bit like that. He tried to hold it. Oh, man, Ben, I've been there. How impressive is that, though, starting as a true freshman in the game at left tackle?
Went in trouble on first and 15, and he is swarmed under by John Lyon, number 62, the junior from Durham, North Carolina, in on the sack.
Quarterback 11, Patrick Witt.
Lyon's one of a couple defensive linemen for Harvard. That was their class valedictorian. He's working against Carberry, and Carberry gets the chip from Elijah Thomas, but the chip almost knocked Lyon back into Patrick Witt. And these are the things that Yale just can't have. I mean, second and 17, this is a great play for a screen or a draw, something to try to split the difference. You're not going to get all 17 yards here on second down.
Now Alex Thomas is back there. You called it. It's a draw. And Harvard expected it too. Josue Ortiz. If we're not mistaken, that could be his first tackle of the game.
Well, and a draw is a good play in that situation if you block it up and you execute, which they didn't right there. Look at what Josue Ortiz did last week against Penn. And a lot of that was early when Harvard was struggling. Everybody was struggling except for him. He really kept them in that game until the offense got going.
He leads the Ivy League with 9 sacks. I have a feeling we're going to call his name a little more often if Yale is forced to become one-dimensional. This is 3rd and 17. Witt has time and finds his man. That pass is complete to Gio Christodoulou. The senior, only his 4th catch of the year. Christodoulou had been a go-to guy in previous years, but it's going to be 4th and long.
Harvard elected to just play coverage. They're just playing deep zone. Obviously 3rd and 17. They'll just let you catch the ball in front of them and then make the tackle just like that. That's just smart defense.
Looked like Witt had to check down, and now Yale has to check out on that possession. Kyle Cazetta, the freshman. Lofts it up, a fair catch by Scott Miller. And Harvard will have excellent field position for their first possession of the second half. The Crimson put up 350-plus yards and 24 points on the scoreboard in the first half.
Oh, look, honey, it's Santa.
I thought I heard reindeer.
Mom, I mean, Mrs. Nelson, I have the perfect gift for you.
You must have gotten my letter. Oh, Santa.
Save 25% on any Citizen watch. Fueled by light, never needs a battery. At K, the number one jewelry store in America.
These are for me, right?
Every kiss begins with K.
Attention homeowners, we know it's tough out there. If you're falling behind on your mortgage, facing foreclosure, or if your home is now worth less than what you owe, we may be able to help. If paying your mortgage has become difficult, even if you're not late, we may be able to help you. NMHC is a service that connects struggling homeowners with companies trained to take advantage of the government incentive plan. Your rate may be adjusted to as low as just 2%, and your mortgage may be cut in half. Call 1-800-556-3073 right now.
Do you have an idea for an invention or new product? Bill Schaefer, co-inventor of the Splash Wash, did. He came up with the idea while watching his children play, and then helped submitted his idea to Wham-O, maker of toys like the Frisbee and Hula Hoop. To find out how InventHelp can help you try to submit your idea to companies, call for free information. Bill Schaefer made a financial gain with his invention. Bill's experience is not typical, and most inventions are not successful.
For your free inventor's information, call 1-800-219-9905.
The whole story with NBC Sports Talk. Mondays and Fridays, join our NFL analysts.
He is the heart and soul of that offense right now. Not Jay Cutler, it's Matt Forte.
Tuesday through Thursday, we'll take you deeper inside all the breaking stories. NBC Sports Talk on Versus.
There you see Tim Murphy, Harvard's head coach, whose team already clinched their 6th Ivy League title last week. Number 4, all-time wins in the Ivy era. Looking up at Bob Blackman, current Penn coach Al Bagnoli, and the great Carm Cosa. Speaking of the great Carm Cosa, there he is on the right. He is the color analyst on the Yale radio network and the Yale broadcast. He has been to a lot of these games, Randy.
His first was 1963. That's how many. 48. Apparently, he's seen them all. There's a reverse to Adam Chrisis as Harvard takes over on its 44-yard line. Chrisis picks up yardage to the 48 about.
The thing that's so amazing to me about Harvard is they don't really have one guy. I said this earlier, but you keep saying a different name every play. That's why they've been so efficient. Who do you say we need to stop this guy during game planning? There is no one guy.
That's one of the guys, Trevor Scales. 46 yards rushing in the first half on 9 carries. Reed Spiller on the stop as Scales gets to midfield. It'll bring up 3rd down and 4. One thing that the coaches talk about that this two tight end situation with Cameron Brate and Kyle Juszczyk does is we have an injured player on the field right now. That's Trevor Scales, who just carried the ball. While we check on Trevor, one thing that the two tight end formation does is it keeps the opposition from really knowing what you're going to do. Let's watch as Scales gets bent backwards.
I hate plays like that. You know, when someone's down near your leg and you get bent back, never like seeing that.
Scales was a little banged up last week and had to leave the game for about a quarter against Penn, but came back into the game midway through the third quarter and actually had an outstanding second half. So let's hope for the best here for Scales. All right, he's to his feet and walking off on his own power. That's a good sign. As we resume play, the ball's in midfield. It'll be 3rd and 4.
Critical play here early in the second half. Harvard was so good on 3rd down in the first half, converting in these situations. Yale needs to find a way to get a critical stop here.
And of course, the freshman Zach Bowden has come in for Scales. You certainly don't lose a lot with Bowden in the backfield, running or catching. And that's Juszczyk, the tight end, tries to duck under, but gets only about a yard. Kurt Stottlemyre, number 6 on the stop. A very important 3 and out there for the Yale defense here early in the third quarter.
It really was. They didn't have anybody down in a 3-point stance. They were all kind of moving around. They came with pressure. Winters got it off, but Juszczyk sort of stumbled after he caught the ball. Yale holds them to a 3 and out to start the second half.
Domrowski will punt. We've seen a 61 and a 51-yard punt in this game already in the first half in this direction. And this one is boomed again. And once again, great coverage by Harvard, but the ball skips a little to the left into the end zone for a touchback. That one a 50-yard punt by Domrowski.
Journey across America, I've learned that when you ask someone in Texas if they want big savings on car insurance, it's a bit like asking if they want a big hat, excuse me, or a big steak, or big head. I think we have our answer.
In fact, separate the real from what happened, Raymond, I could identify another day.
Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
And the speak is trying. Free agent. Beer. Foster's, Australian for beer.
USA Prime Credit, I am Peggy, here for you.
Peggy?
Really, that's cool. Anyway, my card isn't working. Can you help me?
Of course. Solving problems is what I do.
Great. So what are you going to do for me, Peggy?
We'll call with solution in the morning.
What?
Sleep well, my friend.
Kids, let's put the dogs back. And yeah, good. Let's send quick like little bunnies.
Want better customer service? Switch to Discover. Number 1 in customer loyalty. It pays to Discover.
Really? Head & Shoulders is for more than dandruff.
Yeah, it does 7 great things, like giving me a healthy scalp and great looking hair.
We should make that 8 things.
Dude, why don't you just use this stuff?
Head & Shoulders. 7 benefits every bottle.
the Mountain West, and the Pac-12 on Versus. Colorado State at TCU, next. Followed by Colorado at UCLA at 7:30. College football on Versus.
Awesome. The teams in the conference have turned it into, obviously, set a powerhouse conference. It's been a lot of fun to be a part of it these past 4 years.
And Josh Boyce with the catch and the two.
I think TCU and Mountain West Conference have gone hand in hand. I think we've grown to high levels, and they've been a great foundation for us as a program to get where we're trying to get to.
The Horned Frogs come up with the win.
And college football on Versus continues next with Gary Patterson's Horned Frogs taking on Colorado State in Fort Worth. TCU undefeated in the Mountain West right now at 5-0 after that electrifying win over Boise State last weekend.
Yeah, right here on Versus. That game was awesome.
On first and 10 from the 20, Alex Thomas on the carry, stacked up by Alexander Norman.
It's too early to say that Yale should just go exclusively through the air, but they do not want to take a whole lot of time off the clock down three scores. And you've got a quarterback in Patrick Whitman. Just look how big he is. Look how tall he is compared to everybody else in the huddle right there.
He's 6'4".
He's a legitimate pro prospect. You got to allow him to start to spray the ball all around the field. Do what he does best.
He's got a strong arm. He's got the height. On second and 14, Cameron Sandquist.
Completion 9, Cameron Sandquist.
His third reception of the game. Doesn't even get back to the original line of scrimmage, to the 19.
Well, and if I was Yale, I would really think about going to the no huddle, the 2-minute drill, as you see the little wide receiver screen to Sandquist. Another good wrap-up tackle by Norman. Well, he is impressive in space. If I'm Yale, though, I'm going to a no-huddle or a 2-minute because they had some success with that at the end of the first half.
Mordecai Cargill in the game. Witt, 14 for 20, 140 yards. They need a little bit more downfield, though, on third and 12. And that's a screen pass to Cargill. That's picked off. Picked off by Jack Dittmer, number 56, intended for Cargill on a screen pass, and instead it went to the other guy.
Second superb play by Dittmer today. He just read screen all the way. I don't think Witt saw him. And he was able to slide in there and pick the pass off of Patrick Witt. That could be a devastating, fatal blow for Yale. Witt looks off to the right, comes back. I don't think he even saw Dittmer, because Dittmer was standing right there. And what happens is Witt takes so much time looking to the right to try to sell the play. When he comes back to the left, he's not really even looking for a guy like Dittmer. You can see Patrick's very frustrated with himself.
The sophomore Dittmer, his first career interception, and now it sets up Harvard on the 18-yard line. And they'll run it with Zach Bowden. Remember, Trevor Scales limped off the field a little earlier. Bowden carries the ball to the 15. Jeff Dunham, the senior free safety, brings him down.
I really enjoyed talking with Bowden this week when we spoke with him. I mentioned earlier he was 25 minutes away from taking an econ midterm. It's like my worst nightmare right now. Told us how many scholarships he had for baseball, but couldn't turn down the opportunity to play football at Harvard.
On second and 7, that one hung up to the corner of the end zone. Incomplete, intended for Alex Sarkisian, who's already caught one touchdown pass. We've seen Kurt Stottlemyre cover that particular pattern pretty well. He did it again.
Well, he was a man-to-man coverage, too. Inside leverage, he did not panic. That's the key. He didn't panic to get interference call. Turned his head around right as the ball was coming. That's excellent coverage by Stottlemyre.
Third and 7 now. The last time Harvard was down here in the red zone, where they've had a lot of success, Yale held them to a field goal at the end of the second quarter. Under pressure, it's dumped off to the tight end, Brate. Short of the first down.
Good tackle by Jeff Dunham in the open space right there. He flew in from his safety position. Not easy to take down a big tight end like Cam Brate. you'll see Dunham come flying up, wrap him up right around the waist, and haul him down. Dunham's 225, 230-pound safety. He needed all of it right there to bring down Brait.
And that was a blitz by Will McHale, also applying some pressure there to Winters. So we've got Mothender lined up for another field goal. This one will be around 30 yards, 29 to be exact. At an angle, and he missed it. He was kicking it from right to left at the angle because of the hash mark and went wide left. So Yale dodges a bullet here at the Yale Bowl, down 24-7.
Sing through the snow. Laughing all the way.
That's messed up, Steve.
That sweater's messed up.
Cabela's Big Game Hunter 2012, rated T for teen.
Average work pants versus a giant angry beaver. Duluth Trading Fire Hose work pants versus a giant angry beaver. Duluth Trading Fire Hose work pants, tougher than an angry beaver's teeth. Get a pair at DuluthTrading.com.
My father and I sweat a lot. The towel over his shoulder became associated with him. And so I wasn't going to have a towel over my shoulder. My mom calls me and she says, look, I know you don't want to throw that towel over your shoulder because your dad did, but you're sweating like a mule. You look disgusted. Do something. My name is John Thompson, and I am definitely comfortable in my own skin.
I started balding. I didn't like it, and I'm doing something about it.
Only Rogaine Foam is shown to regrow hair in 85% of guys.
I'm like, hey, look at me. It's working.
Go to RogaineFoam.com, and you can get a four-month supply of Rogaine for just $59.95. Order in the next 10 minutes and get free shipping.
Bulldogs and Huskies.
College football on Versus is presented by K Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America. Every kiss begins with K. By Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com for a free rate quote. And by Foster's, Australian for beer. So Yale will take over on the 20-yard line after the missed 30-yard field goal by Harvard's David Mothender. As the Bulldogs desperately need to start getting some points on the board midway through the third quarter and down 24-7. Patrick Witt over the middle. Elijah Thomas, who sees action as a fullback and also as a receiver, making his 11th catch of the year. And on the sideline, unfortunately for the Bulldogs, is one of their key weapons.
Well, and look at that average per catch. Are you kidding me? Almost 22 yards per catch. You know, talking with some of the Yale coaches, they really thought he was on track to maybe even be the Ivy League Offensive Player of the Year, but he's missed a bunch of games to injury.
On second and three, that ball completed from Witt to Cameron Sandquist for first down yardage across the 40-yard line. The sophomore Sandquist, 5'9", 172 pounds, but he's had several catches in this game.
One of the things that's helped Sandquist and Liguori, two guys that really weren't even on the two deep earlier in the season, is they've finally been able to get a lot of the reps in practice because Smith's been out. They've been taking all the reps with the first string.
Five catches for Sandquist in this game. Witt is going to run for it. Took the best of that collision just short of midfield and got the first down.
Boy, I love that. You got to like when the quarterback puts his head down. They're down by 17, but this is his last college game ever. Maybe his last game ever. And Patrick Witt trying to get his sideline fired up. Watch and listen to him finish this run. You can hear the crowd roar as Witt plows through the tackler.
Brian Owosu went the other direction after hitting the 6'4 Witt. That was the first down. This again. This time Witt is forced to keep the ball, and he's dropped for a loss by Namdi Obukwelu, junior defensive tackle for the Crimson. That's a loss of two back to midfield.
Alex Thomas in the game now alongside Witt. As we tick down under the 5 minute mark in the third quarter. Witt changing the play. And that's what he changed it to. Incomplete, intended for Jackson Legory. Trying to get a step on DJ Monroe, who had him covered.
Well, it's very similar, Randy, to the offense. When you look at Harvard's offense, they're all good. There isn't one star that you point out or talk about. That's the same for the defense. Talking with Patrick Witt this week, he said they're not that complicated. You know, they have a lot of single high, cover one, cover three. The problem is there's not one guy that you look at and say, that's the guy we're going to pick on. That's where we can have success. He said they're all good.
On third down, you see the Geico first down line is at the 38, 12 yards to go. Witt forced to check down to Alex Thomas, and he is quickly apprehended. Alexander Norman again in on a stop. It'll be fourth down.
Such a good job by Norman and Gideon, 46 and 49. Sitting back in their zone, rallying to the football, and both of them knowing exactly where their help is, where the other one was, and they funneled Thomas into each other. Thomas had nowhere to go because they both maintained their leverage on his outside shoulders.
Harvard secondary doing an outstanding job against Witt, shutting down all the downfield routes. Witt continually forced to check down. Fourth and nine, and the freshman Kyle Cazetta lined up to punt. But we have whistles and a delay of game.
37 on the offense. 5 yards from the original line of scrimmage. Fourth down.
There's Yale head coach Tom Williams. Trying to figure out exactly what happened there. They're already punting against the wind. That backs them up now to their own 47. We'll try it again. After this slight delay.
You wouldn't think the 5 yards hurts him that much with some of the booming punts Cazetta's had today.
Please reset the game clock to 3:53. 3:53.
Referee Tony Marcel. We've had a pretty cleanly played game today in terms of penalties. Not too many key penalties on either side.
Oh, you never say that, Randy, with this much time to go. You just jinxed it. We could have a flag-filled fourth quarter now. It's not what we want.
We could be here all afternoon.
Nobody
now
wants that.
All right, let's see what Cazetta can do now. He's against the wind, and it's a pretty stiff wind. And that one dies pretty quickly. It'll be down at the 25-yard line. After a high-octane first half, no scoring yet in the second half. There is a flag on the play. We'll deal with that on the other side of this break. At the Yale Bowl, Harvard leads 24-7.
Miners trust the makers of Peak Antifreeze to protect their 600-ton ore haulers from extreme conditions. You can trust Peak Antifreeze's unique formula to help protect your engine from costly repairs. Peak Antifreeze. Protect your ride, no matter what you drive.
Peak Antifreeze. When you peak, you win.
Oh, we miss you, honey.
I'll be home soon. Until then, I have my wingman helping me out. Tommy?
I helped Dad pick it up.
Beautiful.
Behind every open heart is a story. Tell yours with my open heart collection at K Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America. There are millions of reasons to give one, but the message is always the same. Keep your heart open, and love will always find its way in.
I love you.
I love you too.
Every kiss begins with K.
TireRack.com is more than just an online tire resource. We're your one-stop online tire know-how, know-who, and know-what. With TireRack's online research tools, you'll know you're getting exactly the right tires for you, your car, and the way you drive it. Speaking of that, know what else? Our prices are practically unbeatable. And that's all you need to know. Buy your next tires at TireRack and experience how we're revolutionizing the way you buy tires. TireRack.com. Research. Buy. Deliver. Install.
Tonight on NFL Turning Point, Mark Sanchez and the Jets called a costly timeout, and the Patriots seized the opportunity. NFL Turning Point with Dan Patrick, tonight at 11 on Versus.
That penalty turned out to be against Harvard's DJ Monroe.
Yeah, it was a personal foul. You'll see it at the right side of your screen, number 36. Look all the way to the right. He's blocking the gunner. Hits him. He's okay then right there. You're allowed to hit him as long as you're still in the field of play. But when you went right there that one more time, you can't keep blocking him when they're out of bounds like that.
You can't block him on the bench.
Correct.
That's illegal. Half the distance to the goal has moved Harvard back to the 13-yard line. And that's where Collier Winters and Trevor Scales will begin. And that was Winters, intended for Sarkisian. Low and outside, incomplete.
One of the things about Harvard, they don't really change their offense no matter what the score, no matter what the scenario. It's one reason why they've scored 30-plus points in seven straight games and why they've been averaging 473 yards of offense for the last six games. They just keep going. No huddle. They'll throw it. They'll run it. They stick with their plan.
And this is Scales getting across the 15-yard line. Austin Pulsifer, 96, in on the stop. It'll bring up third and seven.
Good to see Scales back in the game. Second or third time Winters has come back and thrown the ball to the guy he initially faked it to.
Five wide receivers, empty set backfield. It was. Now Scales moves back alongside Winters. And it is thrown toward Lordich. Incomplete. Matt Battaglia with pressure. And Harvard will have to punt it away again.
Yeah, Yale's defense is doing the job here so far in the second half. They are doing the job, and now the offense has to help them out. Or maybe the special teams.
Well, Gio Christodoulou is just the guy to help. He's deep for Yale. He's had three career punt returns for touchdowns for the Bulldog. Again, Yale's all-time leading punt returner. Dombrowski's kicking with the wind, and we've seen some boomers. This one is going to head out of bounds, or at least close to the out-of-bound marker. Takes a kick back in, and it'll be down at the 36-yard line. Chris Splinter down there to down the ball. It's been an interesting week for the Harvard coaching staff, especially three guys who have ties to Yale. Joel Land, the offensive coordinator, Tony Reno, both coached at Yale. Chris Barber, the wide receiver coach, was a quarterback for the Bulldogs in 95-97. For more on that, let's go down to Carolyn.
Well, Randy, Joel Lamb, Harvard's offensive coordinator, has a very interesting take on the game. He went to the game as a high school senior, played at Harvard, was a coach at Yale for 9 years, and now has been with Harvard for 6 years. Tim Murphy told me he jokes around, says, blood's thicker than water, and I'll tell you something else after this play.
They've been giving those guys a hard time all week long. That's Cameron Sandquist on the receiving end of that one. Let's go back down. Finish that story.
Well, what I just wanted to tell you was that I told Joe to make sure that he remembers his crimson colors today, not his blue colors. He laughed. He said, Carolyn, do not worry about that. Do not worry about that. Back to you, Randy.
Yeah, what a rivalry this is. That was a first down completion, by the way, to Sandquist. That's complete to 84. Jackson Lagore. Some of the players, some of the coaches sort of describe this rivalry as a friendly rivalry until it gets to game day.
Well, there's just a tremendous amount of respect between both these institutions. You know, they compete with each other for professors, for students, for everything, really. See, Witt is changing the play, and he moved Thomas the other side, likely to help him out in protection.
Second and six. Nice catch over the middle by Deion Randall for a first down. The sophomore, Brian Owusu, on the coverage.
Harvard came with pressure, but Witt had time. Put it right in front of Randall. Yale's had a lot of success with those in-breaking routes. Quick slants. It's
That's pretty good for a kid that played quarterback in high school. It's his fifth catch of the game. That one Alex Thomas couldn't quite hang on to over the middle.
Pass intended for 41.
Well, there was one earlier that I said, I think Patrick Witt could have made a better throw, but Alex Thomas still would have told you he should have caught it. This time, I think Alex Thomas would tell you he just needs to catch that. What happens is you get so anxious to try to make a play with the ball in your hands that you start to look downfield before you actually secure the football.
Witt comes right back to Randall to the 30-yard line. Alex Gideon on the stop. It'll be third and five. Harvard methodically moving down the field. They desperately need to put points on the board here as we tick down inside a minute 30 remaining in the third quarter. Witt has now thrown for 198 yards. He's 21 for 30. He's having a good game. They just need to put it in the end zone. That pass in and out of the hands of Sandquist. Dan Minamidi, number 9, with the hit to knock the ball loose, bringing up fourth and five.
That was 9-on-9 crime right there. Minamidi with the coverage on Sandquist, and it was excellent. Sandquist had it in his hands. Minamidi threw him down. You see the hit that Witt took from Gideon just as he let go of the football. I think Sandquist would be the first one to tell you he should have caught that ball. Went through that on the money under pressure.
So fourth and five. Intercepted. Jaron Wilson picks it off. The second interception thrown by Witt in this game.
Witt had plenty of time. Harvard came with pressure, and Witt had all kinds of time. But as he tried to rifle the ball in there against the zone, he threw it right to the Harvard defender. Look at it. Threw it right to him. Not exactly sure what Witt saw on that play.
Witt has been inconsistent this season. He's had 17 touchdowns, but 13 interceptions plus 3 lost fumbles. And he's had 2 key interceptions in this game. So Harvard takes over at the 40. Winters keeps it close to the first down. Matt Battaglia there to run him out. Right at that first down marker. There's Witt. He does now have a touchdown pass against Harvard, but those 2 interceptions have been costly.
Yeah, that was the thing he had to avoid today, especially that one right there. The screen pass, I could almost understand because he was trying to sell the fake, but that one, not quite sure what was going on in that play.
That last run by Winters was a first down. That pass batted down at the line of scrimmage.
Collier Winters pass intended for 89.
Looked like Matt Battaglia got a hand on it.
Take a look one more time at the interception. You'll see him just sitting back in the zone. It's Jaron Wilson. And Witt threw it right to him. I mean, Witt had eyes for Sandquist. I guess he just didn't see Jaron Wilson. That's a mistake by Patrick Witt that the Yale Bulldogs could not afford.
That pass incomplete. Intended for Scott Miller, number 25.
Although I will say this, that was fourth down. So it's never a good time to throw an interception. But net-net, it's not that devastating of a blow because it was going to be a turnover on downs if they didn't complete it anyway.
The main blow is that Yale not being able to put points on the board, trailing 24-7 now as we're getting close to the end of the third quarter. They've got nothing done in the second half. Winters just heaves that one up. And it's caught. It's caught by Sarkisian. That looked like just a desperation throw by Winters. And Sarkisian comes down with it. Pat Moran applying the pressure. How about that?
Well, that is what you call trust. Either that or a terrible decision by Collier Winters, because there's Yale guys all over him. He just chucks it up there over his off his back foot, and Sarkisian was hand fighting with Baldwin, able to come back and make the play.
Yeah, it looks like he could have even pushed off a little bit on Baldwin. That one on first down complete to Juszczyk. Close to another first down.
You know, when you have a 17-point lead, like Harvard does, you don't throw that pass. I mean, you don't take that chance, but that just shows how much faith and trust he has in Sarkisian to make the play.
And we are done with three quarters at the historic Yale Bowl. For the final 15 minutes, Harvard will take a 24-7 lead in the game. One of college football's most historic rivalries, a game that Harvard has won 9 of the last 10 meetings.
The most headroom per dollar of any car in America from 10,990. The all-new Nissan Versa sedan. Innovation upsized. Innovation for all. The most legroom per dollar of any car in America from 10,990. The all-new Nissan Versa sedan. Innovation upsized. Innovation for all.
Feeling vulnerable?
Oh. I bought my car insurance policy online without an agent. Now I feel totally unprotected.
With a local Arbella independent agent, you'll get coverage that, well, covers you. Go to Arbella.com to find an independent agent near you.
Excuse me.
The Mountain West and the Pac-12 on Versus. Colorado State at TCU, next. Followed by Colorado at UCLA at 7:30. College football on Versus.
The official training bike of the Tour de France, the ProForm TDF, the first ever indoor training bike that delivers everything you demand. A 20% incline and a 20% decline, so you'll experience exactly what the road does. Because it's powered by Google Maps, you choose the road and the TDF follows it. Every incline and decline, so no matter what comes at you, you'll be ready. The ProForm TDF automatically adjusts resistance, incline and decline. Plus, with a built-in power meter, you'll know your exact output. You decide where to go, and the official training bike of the Tour takes you there. And now that you've decided, we're ready to deliver. Order right now and get zero down and a free upgrade on rush shipping. Call the number on your screen or go online today.
The Harvard Crimson cheerleaders have something to cheer about. Their team is up 2 touchdowns plus over the Yale Bulldogs, and today's attendance at the Yale Bowl, 55,137. Look at the attendance since around the turn of the century, 1903. Oh, close to 2.2 million fans have seen this contest. Harvard has a 2nd and 1. Look at the freshman, almost untouched, Zach Bowden. From 12 yards out, as the Crimson pour it on.
We mentioned that the unsung heroes of this Harvard offense, it's the offensive line. They only start one senior, Kevin Murphy, but that was about as well blocked as it gets. Bowden had quite the burst hitting that hole for an easy touchdown for Harvard.
He was quick into the line. Mothender splits the uprights. And that makes it 31-7 on the first play of the fourth quarter.
Yale came with a stunt. Jack Haluba, the center, got up on Jordan Haynes, the linebacker. And that's about as easy as a touchdown run will be. Not even touched, so he gets about to the 1 yard line because of the excellent blocking up front from his Harvard Crimson upperclassman.
Trust me, I won't say this very often. I might have been able to run through that hole.
I think you would have been tackled at like the 4. You're not nearly as fast as Bowden.
But I could have run through the hole. Coming up next, over on NBC, Notre Dame takes on its longtime rival, Boston College. It'll be the final home game this year in South Bend. Again, you can switch over to NBC for that one on Notre Dame Saturday.
Well, hey, and if they get that win, And then they play Stanford next week. Even though they have three losses, it could end up finishing up to be a pretty solid season for the Irish. Got to get that win at Stanford, though.
There's Harvard head coach Tim Murphy. You talk about the final home game played this year at Notre Dame. For many of these seniors, 99.9% of them playing on both teams, this is the final game, period.
Right, and if you look at Harvard, you know, there is no FCS playoffs for the Ivy League champion. I think it's quite the shame. So even for Harvard, even though they've been so dominant, this is the end for them as well.
That kickoff gets past Chris Dodulu, hung up in the wind. He retrieves it and runs it out to about the 18-yard line.
It's a tough moment for all these seniors. They've got 14 minutes and 55 seconds left of football. And think about what football's meant to them. You know, not only is it the sport that they love and play, but it had a big impact on them having the opportunity to attend schools like Harvard and Yale. Putting on the helmet and shoulder pads for the last time. Boy, it's tough for me even to talk about it, to be honest with you. It's just, unless you play, you don't really know what it feels like.
A few of these guys, including Patrick Witt, who just completes that one over the middle to Alex Thomas for the first down. A few of these guys continue to harbor NFL aspirations. In Witt's case, it's a combination of his size, 6'4", ideal for an NFL quarterback, and also his arm strength. His consistency needs to improve a little bit.
Well, and that's what Harvard head coach Tim Murphy told us when we talked to him about Witt's pro prospects.
And he's brought down in the backfield for a sack. That's more of a coverage sack than anything else. Jake Boy, his second sack of the year. There he is, the sophomore, number 94. But you've got Josue Ortiz, who definitely has some NFL chops, or at least some scouts think.
I think the guy with the best chance in this game is Kevin Murphy, the left tackle for Harvard. I think there's some other guys that will get an opportunity, but that doesn't mean they'll ever actually play in a game again.
After that sack resulted in a loss of four, that one incomplete, Deion Randall, the intended receiver.
You know, just watching, looking out in the field and looking at the scoreboard, it's really just a testament to how dominant this Harvard team has been. I mean, Randy, I've been following the Ivy League since my freshman year in 1997, and I can't remember a team that ran roughshod. You see Collier Winters, the captain, Alex Gideon, that ran roughshod over the league like this. I mean, none of the games have really even been that close.
The only game that's kept them from an undefeated overall season, as you see that one complete to Alex Thomas, was their first game of the year, a non-conference game against Holy Cross, which they lost 30-22. After that, they've run the table.
Yeah, look at the last six games in particular. Cornell actually gave them a little run for their money, only lost by 10 points, but everything's double digit, double digit, double digit. That is not usual for a league like the Ivy League. You don't often see that.
So fourth and four, trailing 31-7. Yale's going to punt it away. Kyle Cazzetta to Scott Miller. Miller across the 35-yard line. Harvard has been putting up the yards, putting up the points all season long. They're undefeated in the Ivy League, and they're 13 minutes away from staying that way.
Inside and out. Introducing My Lowe's, a revolutionary new way to keep track of, organize, and manage your entire home. Register your home at Lowe's.com. Lowe's, never stop improving.
There's a reason our KFC Famous Bowl is famous. Okay, five reasons. Layered together for what might be the world's best tasting full meal. How do we make that recipe even more famous?
We put bacon on it.
Wow. Another one for the Colonel. Introducing the new KFC Cheesy Bacon Bowl. Try it right now for only $3.99.
Everything's better with bacon.
No argument here, Rachel. Today's a KFC day. Today tastes so good.
Price, anchor one of the toughest back ends in the East. But Boston is armed with their own young guns. Bruins, Canadiens. Coverage begins Monday at 6:30 on Versus.
Not your average college football attire for Harvard-Yale. She has Harvard tinted sunglasses. That fur coat is big enough to have belonged to a grizzly bear. There's another in the legion of fans who have begun to thin out a little bit here.
Was that her hat or her hair?
I think it was a hat. I'm hoping it was a hat.
That is awesome.
Only her hairdresser knows for sure. And there is an Ivy League tie for you right there. Okay, first and 10 for Harvard. Collier Winters keeps it to the 35. Let's go back down to the sideline now to Carolyn Manham.
Well, Randy, as you walk around to some of these tailgates earlier this afternoon, I got a chance to walk around a little bit. You really see some interesting stuff. Escargot being served, white linen tablecloths being spread out. I mean, I'm from the SEC. We wear jean shorts down in Florida, so some interesting attire. Definitely fun for me, Randy.
All right, that's Trevor Scales on the carry. I've heard some alums this past week reference the rivalry in this way. A lot of academia in universities around the country, particularly the Ivy League, look down their nose at athletics. But when it comes to Harvard versus Yale, even a percentage of some of those people will come out for the tailgate and for the rivalry and for the game itself. Third and 6. From the 40, that's a first down and much more to Juszczyk, the tight end. Let's see what kind of speed he's got. Wow. He's got enough. How about that? 60 yards for the tight end, Juszczyk. His 7th touchdown of the season and the longest reception of his career. Adding salt to the wound in the fourth quarter.
Boy, Juszczyk has some wheels, doesn't he? Watch him. Winters gets the ball out of his hands fast. It's a quick out. O'Connell took a bad angle, and then it was all Juszczyk, and they couldn't catch up to him. He was pulled away, the 235-pound tight end. Wow. That's impressive.
The cornerback, Drew Baldwin, couldn't make any headway on him. A 60-yard pass play capped by Mothender's extra point. Collier Winters now 27 for 42. 355 yards passing. He's got some rushing yards as well as the Crimson are pouring it on. 12-11 remaining in the game. They're up 38-7.
Through the snow. Laughing all the way.
That's messed up, Steve.
That sweater's messed up.
Cabela's Big Game Hunter 2012, rated T for teen.
$100 for a pair of jeans? Give me a break. I wear Lee Premium Select because they fit, they're comfortable, and they cost less than $50. And according to studies, I've been told they make my butt look good. Researcher.
Getting comfortable never looked so good.
Is too much paper slowing down the productivity in your business? Well, maybe it's finally time you tried a NeatDesk scanner and organizer. A NeatDesk is like a digital filing cabinet that can scan business cards, receipts, contracts, all your business documents. The NeatWork software then automatically organizes those documents while extracting key information. With NeatDesk, that stack of business cards can go directly into your computer's contact list. Best of all, virtually any business record automatically becomes a searchable document that you can find with a simple keyword.
Our organization is all about efficiency, and with the Neat Scanner, what used to take an hour is now taking a minute.
And now, for a limited time, if you call or visit us at tryneat.com, you can try a Neat Desk or the amazing Neat Portable Scanner for 30 days absolutely free. In fact, we'll even pay for the return postage if you decide to send it back. So give us a call or go to tryneat.com for your 30-day trial and see how much more productive your business can be.
The whole story with NBC Sports Talk. Mondays and Fridays, join our NFL analysts.
He is the heart and soul of that offense right now. Not Jay Cutler, it's Matt Forte.
Tuesday through Thursday, we'll take you deeper inside all the breaking stories. NBC Sports Talk on Versus.
There, a look at Harvard's two tight ends. Kyle Juszczyk on the receiving end of that 60-yard touchdown pass to the left. Cameron Brate to the right, and they've had a nice afternoon.
Well, they've been doing it all year long, and their versatility is in large part what makes Harvard's offense so effective. And the bad news for the rest of the Ivy League is they're both underclassmen. Juszczyk has another year. Cam Braid has two more years. And if they keep making plays like that, we might be talking about them next year as being pro prospects. How about the wheels from Juszczyk on that play?
They keep the defense guessing. They're big enough and good enough blockers to line up on the line of scrimmage in tight. They can line up in the slot, in the backfield. That kickoff comes down to Chris Dedulu at the 25-yard line, and so Yale will begin from the 34. Alex Gideon in on the stuff. This is a big game for Harvard alums, for Yale alums every year, and the Princeton alum standing next to me here, Ross, his BlackBerry's been lighting up with some texts from people that have participated in this game.
Yeah, I got several texts from Ryan Fitzpatrick, the starting quarterback for the Buffalo Bills. He was texting me earlier after the fumble saying Murphy's number one thing that he preaches is ball security after Winters fumbled earlier in the game. Then later on, he texted me from the plane before they were heading out down to Miami and wanted to know what the score was. So that tells you a little bit about how important this game is.
Yeah, he's going to be happy when he lands. Checks out the final. Deion Randall there, bringing that one in from Witt. To the just across the 40-yard line. Collier Winters has had quite the day. There you see his stats, and that does not, at the bottom there, there you see his rushing stats. So that's 415 yards of total offense and three touchdowns accounted for.
And really a whole other quarter to go. I mean, he's got over 11 minutes to go, and if the game was more competitive, I still think he'll stay in the game, but he could maybe even put more numbers up.
Alex Thomas, almost nothing. Alexander Norman in on the stop. Yeah, I would guess it would be kind of hard to pry some of these seniors out of the game at this point in this rivalry in the final game of their careers.
Well, talking with some of the Harvard coaches, you know, a couple times they've allowed teams back in it. Penn a little bit last week, Princeton, when they put their second units in, they're going to wait a long time before they put their second units into this one, because your second units have struggled and at times given up points and let these teams at least moderately back into the game.
Winters is a senior, so of course is Patrick Witt, scrambling there, under pressure, dumped. It's going to be another fourth down, another big play by number 46, Norman, Alexander Norman.
Yeah, I think it was John Mason who knocked the ball out of Patrick Witt's hands. Witt was fortunate just to be able to pick the ball back up and not lose possession.
Back for Harvard, 25. So Kyle Cosetta again will be punting it away with the wind. Yale just can get nothing going of any consistency offensively. Scott Miller from the 12 to the 19-yard line. 10 minutes to play.
Tackle by five, Will McHale.
Yale scored first, believe it or not. Take a 7-0 lead. 38 unanswered points since then by the Harvard Crimson, who right now are on cruise control.
Here, this is my world. This place inspires me to be tougher, to stay sharper, to think faster. They may be just streets to you, but to me, they are playgrounds. Stop loving you, 'cause I'm alive, I can breathe, I can feel, I
believe. Walter Camp.
Yale.
John Heisman.
Penn.
Pop Warner.
Cornell.
American football was born in the Ivy League. With 53 national champions, three Heisman Trophy winners, and an honor roll of national leaders and NFL stars, its campuses are the gold standard for academic and athletic achievement. The eight Ivy League schools built a game. Tradition lives here.
My father and I sweat a lot. The towel over his shoulder became associated with him. And so I wasn't going to have a towel over my shoulder. My mom calls me and she says, look, I know you don't want to throw that towel over your shoulder because your dad did, but you're sweating like a mule. You look disgusted. Do something. My name is John Thompson, and I am definitely comfortable in my own skin.
College Football on Versus is presented by Lowe's for all your home improvement needs. Lowe's, never stop improving. And by E-Trade, investing unleashed. And Harvard has unleashed some offense on Yale in this game after somewhat of a slow start. For the second week in a row, Ross, last week against Penn, Penn scored first. Harvard responded with 37 unanswered.
Yeah, I guess that's their MO now, their modus operandi. Let the other team score first, get their hopes up, and then put 37 or 38 on them.
All right, there is Collier Winters with Matt Battaglia on the stop.
Collier Winters.
Across the 20-yard line to about the 23.
I would expect to see a heavy dose now of Trevor Scales and Zach Bowden, both of whom averaged over 7 yards per carry last week against Penn. Penn is so known for their run defense, and yet even late in the game, third and fourth quarter, like the same situation we're in now, Harvard was able to run on it pretty effectively. And you can see now they're huddling. They're taking some more time off the clock now. No more no huddle for them with this size lead in the fourth quarter.
That's Trevor Scales on second down and 7, just across the 20-yard line.
And this is going to be a great regret for these Yale players. I mean, I can tell you, in my 4 years, I was never able to beat the Harvard Crimson either, and it still bothers me. I mean, I'm 32. I haven't played in the Ivy League in 11, 12 years, whatever it is. And you see some of these seniors, Dooley and Baldwin. You know, that's something that kind of lives with you forever, that you're never able to get a win in this game. But give credit to the other side. Give credit to Harvard for getting it done for the fifth straight year now.
The worst loss by Yale at the Yale Bowl was back in 1960 to Harvard. The worst loss to Harvard, and that was 39-6. 51 years ago. It's 38-7 right now. That play did not net a first down with Trevor Scales, so it'll be 4th and 2, and Harvard with Jacob Domrowski will punt it away to Gio Christodoulou. So this is so far a beating of perhaps historic proportions. Christodoulou forced into retreat and finally calls a fair catch.
Fair catch was called by 30.
What a punt by Domrowski against what has died down. It was a pretty stiff breeze. It's died down a little bit, but that's a heck of a punt. All right, Ross, let's take a look at the Capital One coach's playbook. Go back to the second quarter.
Well, it was a critical call by Harvard head coach Tim Murphy. The fake field goal option, Colton Chapel pitches it to Mothander. He gets one block on the edge from Kyle Juszczyk. And at that point, Harvard had all the momentum. It was 14-7. I expected Harvard just to kick the field goal to go up by 2 scores, but I think that they anticipated Yale thinking the same thing. That's why they came with the fake field goal, and it worked, clearly.
That was your Capital One coach's playbook. That pass thrown into traffic by Witt. 36 DJ Monroe deflected it. Thought he had a shot at it there, incomplete. Witt has thrown a couple of interceptions already. He's going to be forced now just to air it out.
Monroe's done a heck of a job filling in for Matthew Hansen, who's not playing. Hansen leads the Ivy League with 9 passes defense. I think he'll get a shot in a mini camp or a training camp, but came into this one with a bad ankle, not really playing, and clearly they don't need him.
That's a pitch out to Alex Thomas, barely getting back to the line of scrimmage. So Witt, here's the senior, passed up an opportunity for a Rhodes Scholar interview in Atlanta to play in this game. How's he got to be feeling right about now?
Well, I think he's still very content with his decision to be here with his teammates, but I got to say something about that. how is it possible that he can't do the interview tomorrow or done it on Friday? I mean, I've heard this before. I just don't understand that. I mean, what if he was getting married today? You know, I mean, they give you one day for the interview? I don't get it.
There's a draw play. Alex Thomas close to first down yardage. Jack Dittmer, 56, been on the stop. It'll be fourth and one, and it looks like the offense is staying on the field this time with a manageable fourth down yardage. Witt, 25 for 37, 226 yards. He's thrown a touchdown pass, their only touchdown of the game, but of course he had those two interceptions as well. Elijah Thomas, the up back. Alex Thomas behind him. That's going to be close.
Yeah, I think he got it. I think he had enough forward momentum.
James Klein, number 80, in on the stop. It is marked good enough for a first down. Six minutes, 15 seconds and counting.
I got to tell you, I'm really surprised the way Harvard has taken it to Yale. I was surprised last week, though, with the way they blew out Penn. I thought both of these games would be hotly contested, close games. But Harvard, after early stumbles, has just been utterly dominant. And it still continues. They still have the starters out there, and there's still stuff in the Bulldogs.
That was Alex Thomas again. Imagine how devastating it is. You've touched on it once before, but not only on the Yale side of the ball have you got these seniors playing in what for the vast majority of them will be their final football game ever. But now they have to leave college knowing that they never defeated Harvard.
It stinks. I mentioned it. It stinks. But a lot of times it's about the process. You know, I mean, if you did everything the right way in terms of the preparation, summer, working out, there's only so much you can do.
Witt taking a shot there, and he is still down. The pass over the middle. And incomplete. Alex Gedeon delivering the shot on Witt, and he's feeling it.
It's one thing he's done throughout his career is taken a bunch of shots. You see Gedeon right there with the helmet to the chest. But Witt always gets back up. I've always been really impressed with his physical toughness and mental toughness with all the licks he's taken over the past 3 years doing a lot of Yale games.
Well, he took some colossal shots against Penn a few weeks ago, and he grooves that one again. There is Gedeon for the pick six. Gedeon delivered the crushing blow on Witt. One play later, intercepts it for the touchdown. The third interception of the game and the second pick six thrown by Patrick Witt.
And if you're Alex Gedeon, who knows, that might be his last play of his life playing football. It's just an out pattern to Keith Cody. Gedeon jumps in front of it, not sure what Witt was looking at because he was standing right there, and a good break on the ball. Gideon's a senior. He forgot he needs to be the wing on the extra point. He ran off the field so excited, he forgot that he's the wingman on the extra point. They had to wait for him. That's funny.
Not a Rhodes Scholarship performance today by the senior quarterback from Yale. Mothender adds the extra point. Remember when we mentioned that the worst loss to Harvard suffered by Yale here at the Yale Bowl was 39-6 back in 1960? Well, with that extra point, it's now 45-7. It's Patrick Witt shaking his head on the sideline.
TireRack.com, we stock an incredible number of tires, nearly 1 million tires. But we don't just stock them, we test them. And we post user reviews so you can find which tires are the best for you and your car. All this at a price that won't slow you down. And that's one in a million, or in most cases, four in a million. The biggest selection of tires. One more way Tire Rack is revolutionizing the way you buy tires. TireRack.com, research, buy, deliver, install.
So has anybody actually started saving for college yet?
Oh, not me.
No, you got time.
We actually started.
Yeah, but how did you even know where to start?
Oh, I found out about the Gerber Life College Plan.
Call now and get started with free information on the Gerber Life College Plan.
Oh, it's a life insurance policy too.
Oh, that's different.
It's pretty much worry-free.
No matter what happens, we get guaranteed safe growth.
We've got to get started.
Call 1-800-764-4560 for your free information.
Attention parents and grandparents of young children. Gerber Life is accepting applications for their affordable grow-up plan. The grow-up plan gives your child $10,000 in whole life insurance protection now, then doubles automatically to $20,000 later at no extra cost. Free information will be sent to parents and grandparents who call now. Help give your child a head start for just pennies a day. Don't wait. Call now for free information.
Call 1-800-523-3104. Call now.
Tonight on NFL Turning Point, Mark Sanchez and the Jets called a costly timeout, and the Patriots seized the opportunity. NFL Turning Point with Dan Patrick, tonight at 11 on Versus.
Welcome back to the Yale Bowl, our Ivy League Association Player of the Game. Surprise, surprise. Number 16, Collier Winters.
Well, he's done it with his legs, including this touchdown run right here. He's also done it with his arm. He is a true dual threat quarterback. He might not look the part at only 5'11" when you see him get off the bus, but once you see him on the field, he makes all the plays you need to get the Ivy League title and another win in the game.
Your Ivy Football Association Player of the Game. Thrown for two touchdowns, ran for another one. More than 400 yards of total offense. Been told all his life he was too short at 5'11". And he's still being told that as he looks ahead to what he would like to be a professional football career. But what a game he's had so far. And this is the third year in a row that Collier Winters has lit it up. Last year he was 13 for 16. Much more conservative passing performance, but a good one nonetheless against the Bulldogs. Christodoulou again forced to try to reel in a kickoff. And he brings it out to the 37-yard line. DJ Monroe in on the stop. How about Alex Gedeon? The middle linebacker. The captain. Returning that interception. The 138th captain of Harvard football. That's what they that's what they call him officially.
He's done a great job as the captain. He really has. You see Winters there and some of the other upperclassmen for Harvard. That's one of the best feelings in football right there, when you know you have it and you can kind of soak it in and enjoy it over the last 5 minutes here. It's a great feeling.
We're seeing some substitutions on both sides, including at quarterback for Yale. Patrick Witt is out. Sophomore John Whitelaw, number 10, is now taken over behind the center. Alex Thomas is still in the game, though, and he carries to the 40-yard line. It'll be Thomas's final game as well. 5'9 senior from Ansonia, Connecticut, which is about 10 miles away from here. His mother's here at the game. In fact, she's seen every game that Alex Thomas has played throughout his entire four-year career here at Yale, including road games. Even when he didn't play much as a freshman, she was in the stands.
Yeah, you see Whitelaw getting the opportunity to run the offense a little bit. He has a great chance to be the quarterback here at Yale the next couple years.
And a very downcast sideline there, as you saw Patrick Witt. That pass batted around by Elijah Thomas, almost picked off by Matt Martindale. There you see some of the Yale seniors and underclassmen on the sideline, but Patrick Witt there, number 11, downcast. Not the way they wanted to go out in their senior years.
And that's the thing for Patrick Witt that I think he'll always probably wish that he'd been able to get a win in this game or to beat Penn. You know, he's put up fantastic numbers throughout his career, but just was never quite able to get that breakthrough victory against either the Quakers or the Crimson.
Whitelaw is going to keep this one on third and eight. And he won't get close to the first down. The ball will be taken out to the 45-yard line. Whitelaw from Hinsdale, Illinois, getting some valuable playing time here. He hasn't had much of it all year. And on fourth and three, the Bulldogs are just going to kick it away. Tom Williams, the head coach of Yale, will be 0-3 now against Harvard by a combined score of
87-38. Much of that happening in this game. They've been close the last couple of years, but this one is pretty one-sided. Here's Kyle Cazzetta. That one gets a Yale roll to the 14-yard line. We've been talking about how downcast the Yale sideline has been. What a great feeling for these Harvard seniors, knowing that they've gone out now with the fifth-year seniors with a couple of titles. Well, more than a couple.
Three
titles.
Yeah, the fifth-year seniors have three rings. The fourth-year seniors have two, and none of them have ever lost to Yale. And they'll be able to have that for the rest of their lives.
And we can't underestimate that when it comes to the bragging rights around these parts. Collier Winters is keeping himself in the game. Rich Jezeski, a junior, makes the carry there. Jezeski is from Hinsdale, Illinois, the same hometown as John Whitelaw, the quarterback that we just saw replace Patrick Witt from Yale.
You see some seniors coming off. I just saw Kevin Murphy, the big left tackle, come off after that first down play. Getting a little bit of a curtain call for what's been a fantastic season.
On the last possession, Alex Gedeon, who'd returned that interception for a touchdown, remained on the sideline to the congratulations of his teammates. .243, and the clock ticking down. A high snap there. Saitu Smith, the freshman who's been playing mostly wide receiver in the backfield for that carry. Missed last week's game against Penn, but he's been returning kicks today, and now gets to run the ball.
And you see head coach Tim Murphy getting the Gatorade bath. That's becoming a very familiar thing for him. You see Ben Grafe, number 29, next to him. Ben Grafe is one of the five fifth-year seniors on this squad, and his roommate's with Chris Lordich. And when we spoke with Chris Lordich during the week, he said, man, I was just talking with Ben the other night, how thankful we are and how happy we are with our decision to come back and play a fifth year here at Harvard.
Well, that's a rare occurrence in football. Two Gatorade baths for Murphy in 2 weeks. Collier Winters and Josue Ortiz got him last week when they clinched the Ivy League title outright with that win over Penn. Now he's shivering on the sideline again as you see Kyle Juszczyk and Collier Winters. Nothing but smiles.
Punting for Harvard,
45-7 here at the Yale Bowl.
You see Winters and his offensive coordinator Joel Lamb embrace. That's one thing you don't think about is the relationships that these coaches form with the players over years. They're with each other more than when they're with their family.
There's the punt by Domrowski. Christodoulou catching what will be the final punt of his career at Yale, an illustrious career. He's a fifth-year senior from Miami. Let's take a look at the Foster's game stats.
Well, just as you would expect, utter domination, over 500 total yards. And the big one, of course, is the four turnovers for Yale that really proved to be the difference. And this game is yet another example of why time of possession might be the most overrated stat ever.
It's what you do with your time, much like life. Those were your Foster's statistics. Minute 6 to play. And Alex Thomas is still running the ball. Does not want to come out of the game. Matt Martindale brings him down after a loss of yardage. Alex Thomas has had quite the career in high school, nearby in Ansonia, here at Yale, and it's winding down. Very bittersweet moment.
You know, for all these guys, I get sad just thinking about what today will be like, even for the teams that won, you know, even for the guys that won.
One final carry for the 5'9", 190-pound senior. And that will wrap it up. Harvard has now beaten Yale 10 of the past 11 seasons. As Collier Winters, our most valuable player, wraps up his career here at Harvard with yet another victory over the Yale Bulldogs.
And you can see the students, as you see Tom Williams and Tim Murphy, the head coaches, from our vantage point up here in the box, we can see the students starting to take the field.
Six straight wins at the Yale Bowl for Harvard, including eight of the last nine times they've been here. And of course, this is the worst beating that Harvard has ever inflicted on Yale here on Yale's home turf.
Pretty good example right here, as you see the students, of how important this game is to them. You know, they'd already clinched the Ivy League title, but they don't take this many busloads of students for an away game for any other game but this one. And you can see them having a chance to celebrate
and then
with the players.
And then they'll go back and start working on their biomechanical engineering degrees. Somewhere down in the middle of all that, Carolyn Mano.
I am in the mayhem with the man of the hour, Collier Winters. Collier, your entire career, you guys have gotten this game. And even though you had the title, you walked out with a win. What does this mean to you and the group around you of veteran guys?
It means everything. I mean, to be able to come out here and finish with a victory with the guys, it's been a great season and a wonderful way to end it.
You guys have been steamrolling opponents offensively. You have so many targets out there. How were you guys able to be so successful against such a good Yale team?
You know, all of our skill guys have made it easy for me. You know, it's my job just to get them the ball, and they've got a bunch of playmakers on offense, and we've been doing it all season.
Coach Tim Murphy here now. Coach, congratulations. It's emotional for the players, but it's got to be emotional for you and the coaching staff as well with this group.
Well, I'm obviously so proud of our seniors, but our coaching staff did a tremendous job in game preparation. Our kids executed since the first game, first loss. Our kids have been so relentless, and we have the best quarterback in the league right here.
Go celebrate. Congratulations. Thank you, guys. Randy, back to you.
Yeah, what a moment. The Yale publicity staff has now corrected their earlier statistic. It's the second worst beating here at the Yale Bowl by Harvard. The worst was back in 1914, but it's bad enough. Harvard once again takes the measure of Yale in the game, 45-7. Let's take it back to New York and Liam McHugh.
Welcome to the College Football Postgame Report on Versus.
Texas Christian University. It was set to settle for a spot in the Big East, but ultimately will wind up bouncing to the Big 12. Today, however, the Horned Frogs can seal the deal on a Mountain West Conference championship. With two games to go, Casey Paul Hall and the Horned Frogs are perfect 5-0 in Mountain West play, but a victory today would remove any uncertainty. With head-to-head wins, when we look at the standings, TCU owns the tiebreak over both Wyoming and the Boise State Broncos. Hey, everyone. Liam McHugh alongside Doug Flutie and Roland Williams. You know, guys, nobody built it up as the game of the century. But after all is said and done, TCU's upset of Boise State last Saturday will almost certainly go down as the game of the season. Let's take a look back.
He's got a receiver out there.
Carter goes up, holds it in, touchdown TCU. Gonna lay it all on the line.
After watching that, it's almost hard to believe that this is a TCU team that dropped two of its first five games. Of course, since then, they've ripped off five straight wins, including that epic upset of Boise. Do you think Horned Frog fans are now at home saying, Andy Dalton who?
Yeah, absolutely. Casey Paulhall stepped right in. First game of the season, put 48 points on the board in a loss to Baylor, but showed his toughness right away. And then last week, well over 400 yards, five touchdown passes, a gutsy performance down the end. Gary Patterson deciding to go for two. Josh Boyd stealing the ball away, getting in the end zone. Showed a lot of resiliency, a lot of character in this team, and just a great effort all year long by Paulhall.
Defensively, Gary Patterson is still pushing his team to get better. I mean, you look at this Boise State game, they gave up 443 yards. The pass rush was inconsistent. He said this week, I have the worst 8-2 football team in America. He's looking for them to get better. And he wants to improve. And also the seniors. If they win this game, they have a chance to be the most winningest senior class in TCU history. That's pretty good stuff.
Patterson's done an amazing job, and maybe he's a psych major, who knows, because he's turned all the right switches. Let's move on from a team trying to lock up the Mountain West to a school looking to punch its ticket to the SEC title game. Kentucky at number 14, Georgia. Aaron Murray earlier this season broke Matt Stafford's single-season TD passes record. First quarter scary moment. Freshman running back Isaiah Crowell injuring his left ankle on the first series. He did not return in the second quarter. It's Maxwell Smith to Tyler Robinson, and it's 10-6 Kentucky. So we go to the third quarter. Smith by Jarvis Jones, and he loses the ball.
Well, they lead the SEC with 25 sacks, and Jarvis Jones, the man, third in college football. Yeah, at some point, you knew this Georgia defense would step up and make some plays.
That was the end of the third. Right off the turnover at the beginning of the fourth, it's Murray to Marlon Brown, a 7-yard TD. That made it 19-10 Georgia. And right now, in the fourth quarter, with just over 4 minutes to play, that is where they stand. The Bulldogs struggling a little bit against the Kentucky Wildcats. We go to the Big Ten. Indiana, number 15, Michigan State. Kirk Cousins, the all-time winningest QB in Spartan history, playing for the most disgusting trophy in college football, the old brass spittoon. And here, it's Cousins. He finds Keyshawn Martin, and then Indiana really does the rest.
Martin made them look like they were standing still, and they didn't want to pull a flag or anything. They just let him go down the sideline.
24-3 Michigan State. Cousins to Edwin Baker, and he runs it in from the 10.
Yeah, Baker just showing his speed. Really great balance by Michigan State. Great anticipation on the throw to Cunningham.
Cousins, his 60th career touchdown pass. That leads him one behind Jeff Smoker's school record. The final, 55-3, Michigan State with a win and a Nebraska loss. Sparty would lock up the Legends division. So let's take a look at Nebraska. They were visiting number 18, Michigan. Two of the top running quarterbacks in the game, Denard Robinson and Taylor Martinez, squaring off. But late in the first quarter, it's Martinez awkwardly airing it out.
Awkwardly, low elbow, pushing the ball. But when you have a good run game, this is what happens. Guys get wide open downfield.
Second quarter now, all tied up. Robinson doing what he does best.
Struggled a little early, threw an interception, decided I'm going to use my legs and get into the zone.
Early fourth quarter, Michigan running away with it, and Robinson airing it out to Martavius Odoms.
Might be the best ball we've seen him throw all year. He just turned it loose. He had 180 yards passing on the day, so he can still throw it a little bit.
How about Michigan, 45-17 over number 16, Nebraska. Robinson, 180 yards through the air, 83 yards on the ground, four total touchdowns. As for the Big Ten standings in that Legends division, we told you with a Nebraska loss, Michigan State clinches. They are 6-1, Nebraska and Michigan 4-2 in that division. Michigan State, you'd have to say, pretty impressive season. But Michigan, how impressed were you with them today?
I liked them today. They were defensively shutting down option football in Nebraska, really aggressive. And on offense, Denard Robinson, so explosive.
Absolutely.
Doug Flutie took all your time. I'm sorry, Roland. We're taking ever closer to kickoff of TCU and Colorado State. Coached by Gary Patterson, Steve Fairchild. We'll send you out to Fort Worth right after this.
The spake is drying. Helmet. Beer. Foster's, Australian for beer.
Hey guys, I know I told you that Head & Shoulders for more than dandruff, how it gives me a healthy scalp and great looking hair, but who used mine up?
It was Heinz.
Seriously?
You lying fool.
Head & Shoulders, 7 benefits every bottle.
Feeling vulnerable?
Oh.
I bought my car insurance policy online without an agent.
Now I feel totally unprotected.
With a local Arbella independent agent, you'll get coverage that, well, covers you. Go to Arbella.com to find an independent agent near you.
I'm Mike's TV, and we just moved here from Boston. And while my man left his girl, he couldn't leave his Bruins. So we just ordered NHL Center Ice. With up to 40 out-of-market games a week, many in HD, keeping track of your favorite team has never been easier. Watch the Penguins from LA, Blackhawks from New York. With NHL Center Ice, you can follow your team all season long. It's like Thomas and Chara moved in with us, and we're all roommates. NHL Center Ice. The game lives where you do.
Don't miss any of this season's action on DirecTV. Call 1-800-GET-SPORTS today.
After 7 years, The Rock returns to action to team with the most unlikely superstar, his WrestleMania opponent, John Cena, as they battle The Miz and R-Truth.
So Rock, so Cena, if you want some, come get some.
Two of WWE's biggest superstars, the most charismatic tag team of all time, never before, never again.
WWE Survivor Series, live this Sunday on DirecTV pay-per-view.
The resurgent UCLA Bruins are driving towards a division title, but Colorado is determined to make it a rocky road. And in the Mountain West, TCU's Casey Paul Hall has been stellar through the air. But Colorado State's defense is dead set on bringing him back down to earth. Colorado State at TCU, next. Followed by Colorado at UCLA at 7:30. College football on Versus.
Colorado State's search for a season-defining win brings them to Fort Worth, Texas today, where Gary Patterson's Horned Frogs are flying high after handing Boise State its first loss last week. 22 consecutive Mountain West Conference wins on the line as the Horned Frogs play host to the Rams. The Mountain West Conference game we have been waiting for all season. Number 5 Boise State playing host to the defending conference champion TCU Horned Frogs, and away we go. Paul Hall wants to go deep. Touchdown, TCU.
Paul Hall is playing outstanding.
You go for 2 here and try and win it.
Rolling out and firing. Josh Boyce with the catch and the 2. Push to the right. And TCU wins 36-35. The TCU Horned Frogs back in the top 25, ranked number 19, back at home here in Fort Worth for the first time in 4 weeks. Today, playing host to the Colorado State Rams. And when TCU lost here just on October 1st to drop to 3-2, a third consecutive Mountain West Conference title seemed a long way away. Well, here we are 7 weeks later, and that goal is right in front of them. Gary Patterson's Horned Frogs in control of their own Mountain West Conference destiny after 5 consecutive wins, a feat that would not have happened without the poise and the production of sophomore quarterback Casey Paul Hall. Sean King, this will be the third time that we have seen Casey Paul Hall play this season. We know him awfully well by now, a lot to like. What do you like best?
I like a lot of different things about the young player. Casey Paul Hall has been outstanding in filling in for Andy Dalton. You put the tape on and things just jump off the screen. The first being mobility, the ability to extend the play when things break down. For a young quarterback, he plays with a lot of poise, has mental toughness. He's a big kid. Ideal size for the quarterback position, standing 6'5". You couldn't ask for anything more from a pocket passer. And he has that down-the-field vertical arm strength that you love, which really allows TCU to push the football vertically down the field.
And Casey Paul Hall playing like a veteran, Sean, but he is only a sophomore. However, he will be the veteran quarterback on the field today as Colorado State will roll out Garrett Grayson, the freshman. He wanted to redshirt, but that redshirt came off last week when starter Pete Thomas sprained his MCL. So away they go with the freshman leading the way. At least, though, he has Chris Woke, the conference's number 2 rusher behind
Steve
him.
Steve Fairchild wants to run the football. Chris Woke has been outstanding, especially the last 3 weeks. Low center of gravity, powerful, dynamic. dynamic type of a rusher actually reminds me of a smaller version of Maurice Jones-Drew.
And a win today for the TCU Horned Frogs, and TCU would clinch at least a share of the Mountain West Conference title with two conference games remaining. And also, a win would make this senior class the winningest in the history of TCU football. They can do it right here at home.
We have a saying around our place, protect the target. One of the things I never want to do in my tenure is I never want to break Fort Worth's hearts.
Josh Boyce, touchdown TCU.
You really don't lose too much, and you got the home crowd behind us. It's nothing like the Carter Stadium.
Journey across America. I've learned that when you ask someone in Texas if they want big savings on car insurance, it's a bit like asking if they want a big hat. Excuse me. Or a big steak. Or big head. I think we have our answer.
In fact, separates real from what I've been dreaming after fight another day.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Crouching in average jeans. Crouching in Duluth trading ballroom jeans. Duluth trading ballroom jeans. The crotch gusset gives you room to crouch without singing soprano. Get a pair at DuluthTrading.com.
It's easy to see what Subaru owners care about.